Welcome, everyone, to the very first edition of The Strip Show. I'm Stefan, along with Brandon. Is that cool if I say your name?
Yeah, sure.
Are you sure?
No, it's cool, dude.
All right, this is what we are. All right, we're dropping the personas. This is my voice for this show. How are you doing today?
I'm doing good, doing good.
Are you ready for The Strip Show?
Yeah, no, I'm always ready.
I mean, who doesn't enjoy a good strip show? All right, folks. Well, this... okay, I can't do this. Oh, my gosh. Can't keep that up. I can't keep that up the whole time. Do you mind if I call you, like, Brandy? Like, for short? You call me
it's
Steffi?
It's the same amount of syllables, dude.
You call me Steffi?
I mean, if you want.
No, let's not do that. All right. Anyways, this is a brand new show. It's going to be Temp and I, or Brandon and I, whatever. This is going to be weird. It's going to be hard getting over that. But I'd like to just kind of take off the front a little bit for this show and just kind of just have fun. This isn't going to be a Mortal Kombat centered focus show. So I feel like dropping the MK user board usernames type of thing. For this particular show, I would like to do that. And what this show is going to be all about, it's going to be about comics, it's going to be about movies, hence the name The Strip Show. Comic strips, movie strips, film strips, etc., television, movies, all that goodness that we like to talk about. I'm sure we'll get into some game stuff, of course. So, I mean, it's not going to be 100% thematic or fitting of the name, so to speak, but we're just going to talk about whatever, but it won't be as crazy all over the place, zany of the graveyard shift. That'll be just the graveyard shift now. Temp and I, Brandon and I, son of a bitch, this is a horrible idea.
It'll take practice.
It'll take practice, just like a good fighting game, right?
Exactly.
You just gotta hang in there. You gotta grind it out, as they say. Anyways, so what we're doing here is we're gonna be talking comics. Hopefully leading up to Injustice, we'll be able to break down a lot of comics, talk about comic book characters, talk about comics that we've been reading. Brandon's trying to get in a lot more comics recently and lead up to hopefully Injustice if it's announced. I think we're both trying to get more hyped up for the game, hence the Injustice list that we put out not too long ago, just a couple weeks ago or whatever that was. So check those out if you haven't already. And we're going to get into a whole bunch of other stuff like that. And of course, movies. We're into horror movies and comic book movies and all that goodness, so we'll be talking about that as well. So anyways, starting off, we will not be talking about either of those things. I wanted to talk about real quick, I've actually started playing Mortal Kombat X again. Boo! Yeah! Woo! We love you! We love you! Boo! Okay, but for real though, yes, I've played a little bit more. I don't feel like I want to get back into it, at least not until the netcode is fixed, because, man, does it feel like I'm moving through molasses, and that easily is the most frustrating part of the game.
That'll change. I mean, if the beta is telling at all, like, it's about to get a lot better. Me and Django didn't entirely agree, but I think the netcode is stellar now. He still says it's a lot better, but it does struggle here and there. That has not been my experience. I think it's fantastic right now.
I wish I could play. I wish I could. I mean, I feel like they should have put out more beta codes. I don't know what... They were giving away some on Twitter and this and that. And it's like, why don't you just give it to the people that have actually, you know, have played? Why didn't they go to the, you know, the community websites and start throwing them out there and do all this thing and throw some to us, you know? I mean, we're not... It's not like we have this huge listener base, but I mean, it would still be nice to cover the damn thing, and at least you and Django get your hands on one through one way or another. And yeah, but it's unfortunate. I would love to try it because I was playing it earlier, and I would have enjoyed it. I feel like much more had I got to try the smoothness of it, because just playing as it is now, there's still a lot of... I'm dropping combos left and right that I land pretty consistently. I'd say 90% of the time in training mode, I can keep doing it over and over. And then when it gets to an actual trying it online, I can't hit it to save my life. And that's just frustrating to me because it's the difference between 10% and 25% every time I manage to get in. And that kills me, literally.
Oh, yeah, that's a big fucking difference, too. And especially if you use meter and it, you don't get maximum damage, that's a huge waste. But, I mean, yeah. I guess rewind a bit, I totally understand why I did not get a code. My PS4 stick is broken right now, so I send it for the Xbox beta, but my WB account wasn't linked. It was only to the PS4, and I forgot about that. I just wasn't aware of that. So I updated it. It has since now been linked, but... Right. It's probably too little too late at this point. So sure. Once again, shout outs to McLucifer and Redman for hooking me up on that.
Yeah, that was very cool of them. I mean, you're banned from the, you know, our group and listening to us, of course, because
oh, completely.
You could have given me one.
But if you played the beta, you would know it's totally worth it. It's absolutely cool.
I mean, we're picking favorites now, I see. It's cool. It's fine. You play a few games with Temp here and there, and all of a sudden you just throw him all the good stuff. Oh, no, it's fine.
I'm Hollywood now.
Yep. Yep. This is what's happening. No, but for real, though, it was a lot of fun. I was actually trying to get better with Kenshi. I was landing some, you know, 33% combos pretty easily in the training mode with him, and I was doing really well with him. I was liking him. I won a few matches online with him, and obviously I was working on my katana quite a bit more. I found a nice combo that starts mid but goes low for the second hit, which is nice because I didn't know she had one that actually had something that had low in her combo, which is at least something, because that was tripping somebody up online, which is nice because those mix-ups, I'm gonna get in a whole rant about mix-ups here in a second, so, because that's honestly the thing that frustrates me most about this damn game is mix-ups. Like, I can't overheads and low mix-ups, like Jason's, for example. He goes low, then he goes, I think he goes low, mid, high, or overhead, low, mid, overhead, and he can do that 3 times in a row if he hits it, but all you need to fail is obviously the first one, so frustrating, so frustrating. I just don't have the reaction time, especially with how slow it is and the lag and the delay and all that, to go to block low and then immediately block high. Like, ugh, it just kills me. But anyways, so that's frustrating to me, that not that they exist, that not every fighter has them. Katana doesn't have any overhead combo starters that I'm aware of. She only has one overhead move to begin with, I'm pretty sure, and that's her back two, which I use to, you know, trip people up with, you know, tripping them and then using back two when they block low, but it's not giving me, you know, it's not opening up to a 30% combo or anything. That's like a 8% damage is what I'm getting from it. So it's frustrating that not everybody has the same kind of tool set when it comes to combo starters and mix-ups and that kind of stuff. I just wish that if it's going to exist, I wish each fighter had the same potential in that regard, because I struggle with it with Katana and getting in, because nobody really has to. People can block low the entire time and block all of my combo starters, so that's frustrating. And obviously I can jump in with an overhead, but then, I don't know, that's a lot more, I feel like that's a lot more predictable and more, what's the word I'm looking for? I'm basically, you see that coming a lot more than you see a combo that has 3 hits where one's low and one's overhead. That one's going to trip people up more than somebody jumping in. But anyways, I just, that frustrates me. I wish everyone had that. But other than that, I'm enjoying it. I'm enjoying playing Katana. I lost as many as I won, so, I mean, I went back and forth. Some people kicked my ass, some people... Is that my phone? That's my phone. Okay. Anyways.
No, I see where you're coming from completely. With Katana, the cool thing about her is she still has her air conversion, so I know in MK9 it works consistently. I'm pretty sure it still works consistently in MK10, but you can go in with a jump kick, convert into an air fan, and that makes all your jumpings pretty safe. It's
right.
Very, very difficult to anti-air a really good jumping 3.
Sure.
Another thing is that she can feign her jump-ins with that that air cancel she does. I see Sonic Fox do that all the time.
I've done that, yeah.
I absolutely agree with you, though. I do wish this game wasn't as mix-up heavy, because I feel like this game overall is much less diverse when it comes to strategy. I feel like all the really top tier characters are of one of two categories. They're either extremely mix-up heavy, or they can bypass the fundamentals of the game and get free pressure, free setups when other characters don't. Sure. Or like Demolition Sonya is a good example. I was ranting about her in the Warrior Shrine. Never has to use meter. you know, always gets free setups once she has grenades. People are like, well, she has to get the grenades first. She gets the grenades on a knockdown. That's not, you're going to get multiple knockdowns in a game, but yeah, that stuff like that does kind of bother me. I still overall like the game, obviously, but I feel like the footsie game was a lot more sophisticated in MK9. Although at the same time, though, I feel like your options at different distances are a lot cooler. Just the mid-range distance is not as sophisticated as it used to be. Kind of miss that.
Yeah, I'm not knocking the game in general. I like the game. It's fun. The gameplay and all that's never been an issue for me. I've long said my only problems with it is roster and, you know, all the stuff that people have heard me say.
Yeah, I'm done. Stuff.
Yeah, I'm done complaining about that. I'm trying to be more happy and positive and fun and enjoying things a lot more, not letting the same things get to me anymore. But I'm just saying, from my time with it thus far, the past couple days that I played most of today, and I played just a little bit last night with you. I'm enjoying it. It's fun. And the gameplay is a lot of fun, but yeah, just the mix-ups are the one thing that still frustrate me. I just can't. It's tough. I don't know. It's tough. Certain characters have low specials. Like a slide is pretty good and stuff. Like, just obviously it's not good for combos and stuff, but just the mix-up in general just really is the thing that really trips me up more than anything at this rate.
It's hard to learn a fighting game when you feel like you're never safe at any distance. You feel like every time you can constantly be checked. That makes learning not super fun.
Sure, sure. It's also frustrating, like I said, not having the combos translate to online play is also frustrating. So hopefully the beta will, or when they end up rolling that out here in like a month and a half or whatever, hopefully, or a month, I guess, would be. It's in March 1st when that comes out.
It's not clear. I know MKXL comes out March 1st. I assume all the DLC guys are going to be released after March 1st, but I would think they'll defeat the purpose of a complete edition. So I thought they would be on disc.
I think they will be.
Maybe. I mean, I guess. I mean, they've had enough time. Lord knows. So.
But gotta be.
I presume. The beta is in phase 3 right now, so.
Right. I think it will be. I think everything will be ready by then. I think that's their ultimate goal.
I don't complain much these days because I'm just too happy with the game. Right, I'm having too much fun. I don't need to complain. I complain when I want to vent, but I've just been having such a good time playing Mortal Kombat. I don't see the need, and I probably won't see the need for a very long time. You know, so. Yeah, things are. It's not even just Mortal Kombat. Things are looking so good right now. Street Fighter coming out in less than 2 weeks. We have Killer Instinct Season 3, which is looking spectacular.
Oh, yeah, the Arbiter from Halo. Mm.
Sure, why not?
Mm.
I mean, the teaser seems to indicate the Arbiter.
That's what I heard on websites, yeah.
Well, when you get a chance, watch the teaser. It does. I mean, I don't know how it could be anyone else in the Arbiter, but officially, they have not officially announced the Arbiter.
I don't know who else they would put in there. They put a version of a Spartan in, what was that, Dead or Alive, I think, a while back. And then, so I doubt they would do a Master Chief again. I think they would do Arbiter, which makes somewhat sense, sure.
Maybe. I mean, I don't see why. It's the Arbiter. I mean, we can safely say it's the Arbiter. It just officially nothing's been announced yet. But they did something really cool, which is Keats and Del Ryuk. I think that's his name.
Keats?
Adam Hart Keats.
That's a funny name.
Keats. It's a great name.
It reminds me of that movie Bulletproof with Adam Sandler and Damien. Damien, yeah. Keats. That was his name that he gave him. Keats. Anyways.
No, but they did a live panel, and they announced all the patch changes live. And that you got to see everyone's reactions to all the nerfs and all the buffs, and it was very interesting.
Nerf or nothing.
Wait, what?
Nerf or nothing.
No, it was nerf and buffs. Nerfs and buffs.
Nerf. Or nothing.
We will agree to disagree on this point.
So. Nerf or nothing. It's nerf or nothing.
It was cool, like when they would announce nerfs for Saberwolf and everyone would cheer, like that was really cool. I thought that was awesome.
Nerf or nothing.
Cake or death?
Anyways.
Yeah, so that was cool. There's a lot to be happy about. You know, not a lot of bad stuff has happened. I think Doom got delayed. That sucks, but I heard that from a friend. I don't even know if that's officially true or not.
I was turning into you while I was playing online. Like, when people would do fatalities, I'm just like, come on, let's just get to the next match. I was seriously getting annoyed. I was, like, impatient. I don't do fatalities anymore. I don't even care to, like, look them up, how to do them anymore. I just go and punch them in the face or whatever. And, yeah, I was just like, people do a fatality every time they beat me, and it's just like, dear God. It wasn't until, like, everyone else was either super salty or I was getting salty facing them. It wasn't until the last guy that I had a good back and forth with, probably because I got most of the wins, so I enjoyed it more. But he was good. I felt like we were on even keel and on an even playing field. He won the last two, and he won, like, the first two. But other than that, I won the other, like, 8 or 9. And yeah, it was good. I enjoyed playing that one. It was a lot of fun. So, but no, he wasn't salty, and I don't think he was doing fatality. So it was nice to just have somebody continually going.
It does get on my nerves in the beta, where I'll beat someone 3 times. And on the 4th match, they finally beat me, and they teabag, and they fatality, and then they leave. I'm like, come on, man.
Yeah, I only had one person do the teabag thing, and I just left. Because I was like, fuck this. This is stupid. Because I had beat him, I think. And then the next match, and he had beaten me a couple before that. And the next match, he probably didn't like the x-ray too much. So I was using the x-ray against him. And I could tell he was upset about the x-ray, or he was salty about it, because after I had done it on him, there was another time where I missed it. He, like, blocked it, and he immediately started doing the teabagging motion. And then when he finally beat me, he just did the teabagging thing.
Yeah, I don't get that.
I don't know. People are just poor sports, or, I don't know, who knows, poor winners.
I never saw that. I used to play all Street Fighter 4 online. I never really saw that much, but maybe that was a different age. I see it all the time in Killer Instinct, but I play Glacius, and he's a zoner, and he runs away a lot, so I see why they're pissed. I see why they send me hate mail, but
I think it's just a different generation. People are a lot more douchey these days.
Yeah, which is a shame. You know, I like to think that we're all in this together. We're all learning together, you know, and, you know, there's mutual respect. So I always kind of take it badly.
That doesn't exist. Mutual respect is not a thing. It's not. It's horrible.
I love it when I send GG and then they reply, fuck your GG.
Fuck your GG.
Yeah, I know I am.
Reminds me of a game. We were playing Halo. This was many years ago. This is probably around 9 years ago. It was in Halo 3, I think. It was either Halo 2 or Halo 3. And one of my friends, after the game, he said, good game, guys. And one of the guys on the other team just said, shut up. We always laugh about that. It's pretty good.
No, it's fun, but what can you do, you know? I mean, you can't police. I mean, there was a big controversy because Knuckle Doo in the Street Fighter community would do taunts in tournament to psych out his opponents. And it worked. It worked a lot. And there's a whole compilation of him taunting in tournament.
Right.
So it started this big controversy. And it's like, do we ban taunts? Like, is this unfair metagame? I am of the opinion if you can't police kindness. You cannot police people into being nice to others, right? You know?
There's always going to be a way of people getting away with it. Because if they ban certain things that are deemed taunts, then they'll just do something that they'll make up a new taunt that's not necessarily considered a taunt yet.
I mean, in my opinion, it's dirty, and I don't like it. And I think it hurts the competitive level of play, in my opinion. When you're using the psychology of the game instead of the game itself to win, I feel like that's just, it's disrespectful, first of all. I don't ever condone disrespect.
It's showboating. It's rubbing something in somebody's face type of thing.
Well, I don't know. Like, I feel like it makes the community as a whole look childish, but right. I would never say ban it. I mean, like I said, you can't make people not be dirtbags. You can't force people to be good, decent human beings. So yeah, I would never say ban that.
I would never say die.
That's a... Is that a movie?
Nerf or nothing.
I don't know, man. Never Say Die is a Black Sabbath album. But anyway, no.
Live and Let Die is a James Bond movie.
It's
Die Another Day.
Paul McCartney song.
Tomorrow Never Dies. These are a lot of things with dies in it related to James Bond.
I saw all those movies in theaters.
Live and Let Die.
Meow. Meow.
Then there was I Want to Die Another Day. Something.
Oh, I don't know that one.
I don't know. I think it's a Pierce Brosnan one.
Well, you know, man, like fucking.
I could be wrong.
I don't really care for Pierce Brosnan, James Bond, to be
Whoa,
honest.
Oh, okay.
No,
oh,
no,
all right.
No, I'm standing on
That's
my
it for this show. All right. It was a good debut episode. I grew up on GoldenEye.
Well, are we talking about, like, the movie or the N64 game?
Well, both. I mean, you didn't play the N64 game and not see the movie. I mean, come on.
I thought the game was good at the time. It's the movie I thought was not super great, but.
I am invincible.
But was he?
All right. No, he wasn't. He got frozen.
No, yeah, exactly.
He was frozen today. Well, not today, but anyways.
In the 90s. In the
yes.
90s, he was frozen.
But no, that was good stuff. And then you get the little...
Oh, well, Suburban Commando is a great movie. Of course, that's good stuff. I mean, yeah, that's, that movie's amazing.
No, I'm talking about... No.
Well, I was talking about Christopher Lloyd.
No, I know. But that's not the discussion.
Oh, you're talking about GoldenEye still. Okay,
cool. Oh, nipple rubs. All right, Nerf or nothing. Okay, so let's move on here from this discussion about video games and start talking about the comic books. All right. Okay. Actually, let's talk about the Suicide Squad trailer real quick. I don't think we talked about that on the Graveyard last time. I think it got... lost in translation, which is also another movie with Bill Murray. All right, you win.
I also don't think that movie is super great either. I never saw it. The movie's, it's okay. I don't see what the big deal is, to be honest with you. I mean,
meanwhile, on top of the Umbrella Factory.
Is that Resident Evil?
No, that's the old Batman 60s show.
Oh, no, that I did not know. I can safely say I did not get that reference.
All right.
I will never not pick Resident Evil when I hear Umbrella, like always.
Umbrella. Oh, God. Oh, God. Nerf or nothing. Anyways, what was I saying? There was a movie. Suicide Squad, the trailer. I think it looked really good. Do you like it? I thought it was better than the first trailer. I really liked the first trailer, but this one... I felt like is going to sell more to people what this movie's about. It's a lot of fun. A bunch of, you know, bad guys having a good time, fighting a bigger bad guy. And it just looked like a whole lot of action, a lot of humor, a lot of craziness and zaniness and wacko. And I don't know. What'd you think?
I mean, for the most part, it looks a lot more fun. Like, it looks a lot more enjoyable. I feel like a lot of the grit was kind of removed. It was cool hearing the Bohemian Rhapsody kind of sink in with the trailer. It just looks like it's not taking itself as seriously.
Yes.
Tonally, it's much more what I would want out of a Suicide Squad movie. The only real worry I have is we hear a lot of quips from Harley Quinn's actress. I can't remember her name.
Margot Robbie or something like that.
Yeah, the more I hear her talk in the trailer... I don't know, the less I'm not feeling her interpretation of the voice. I guess I'm so used to Tara Strong at this point. It seems a lot more low-key, which for a movie makes a lot of sense. I mean, Harley is not a low-key character. So it looks like they're playing a lot more subtle, which is not wrong. I mean, but that by itself is not bad. But I feel like the over-the-topness is one reason why Harley's character works so good and why she's so immortal in the fans of Batman.
Right.
So.
Yes, as you hear my people in the background.
Yeah, they're having some fun back there.
This is good. It's a party.
I think our cat's fucking shit up, and they're trying to discipline it. We've had a toilet paper problem where the cat takes the toilet paper and then does things with it.
Weird things, like gross things, or like sexy things?
Well, not like Buffalo Bill things, but just like...
Well, I mean, I just... Nerf or nothing. It
what
puts the lotion
mean?
In the basket.
Okay, see, I get that reference. I know what that means. I follow that.
Would you? Would you fuck me? I'd fuck me. I'd fuck me so hard. You gotta put lipstick
on in a mirror. Sometimes you gotta.
It puts the lotion in the basket. Anyways.
That was a little South Park there. But yeah, that works just as well. I mean, it looks fun. I'm not a Suicide Squad fan, so I'm not looking for...
Could you be? Could you be, though?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. But I just want to have fun. If I'm a fan, it's because the movie made me a fan.
Good.
Like, I don't really follow any of those characters.
Good.
So.
Just go in and have a good time. Don't be critical. Don't, like, pick apart the little plot details. Okay. No, you go into the theater, you take a shit, and then you wait in the back, and you wait till you hear a squish. Wait, I'm thinking of Dave Chappelle comedy. Son of a... What were we talking about?
We were talking about Bohemian Rhapsody.
That's a good song. Why were we talking about that? This is a comic
Suicide
book.
Squad.
Oh, okay. All right, Suicide Squad. Yes, the movie. Go in and have a good time, and it looks like the actors are giving it their all. More importantly, it looks like they're having a fun time. It looks like they're legitimately having a good time. And if you followed like Will Smith on Facebook and the articles and all that, Will Smith and they all got like tattoos that said Squad or something or Suicide, or maybe they got some sort of, everyone got a tattoo, and he's like 40 something years old and he's getting a tattoo and he said he's living like he's 20. It's like they're all having a good time filming, they're building a bond, and they're clearly having a good time here. And I think it's going to translate on screen. Margot Robbie, however you pronounce her name, she plays a great Harley Quinn, it looks like. I love the line where she, you know, the voice is telling her to, you know, kill everyone and escape, and then she's like, oh, that's not what they said. Like, you know, the joke of, oh, she's just kidding, there's not really voices, but then it turns out it's not what they said. I like that part. She just, everything she says, the only one thing I didn't really like that she's done thus far with the character is the line where she's like, that's what bad guys do. To me, that seems odd for Harley Quinn to be saying that. Like, Harley's never, to me, come off as somebody that's like, I'm a bad person. She just seems like she's crazy, zany, and having a good time. She doesn't strike me as somebody that's like doing evil things to do evil things. She doesn't even strike me as evil. She's just fucking batshit insane and completely does whatever she wants. She's not,
at least
like,
in the cartoon, she never comes across as self-aware,
right?
Like, ever.
She's not like twiddling her, you know, female mustache and twiddling her. I probably shouldn't have started with that because you can say
sometimes
twiddle her twat. Wait,
I'm sure that happens too.
Let's run that back. Twiddling, twirling was the word. I knew there was something wrong there. Twirling her female mustache with her black. She's not that type. She's not like, oh, I'm going to take over the world. She's not that type of person. She's just fucking, I'm going to do crazy shit. And then when she gets caught, she's just bummed that she got caught and that she has to sit and time out for a while. That's her character. And I like that about her. And I think she's playing that really well. I think she's well written thus far from the trailer. Will Smith is Deadshot. Everybody else looks like they're having fun. Killer Croc doesn't even look that bad, all things considered. They could have made him look way worse. And so he looks okay for, you know, going with like a practical effect mixed with probably some CGI or something. I don't know quite what they're doing with that, but it looks good. Katana looks great. I've already gone on that whole spiel with the Injustice cast. She looks great on, and thus far from what little of we've seen of her, we still don't know who the villain is. So... who knows? But no, it looks good.
Killer Croc, Django brought up an interesting point on the Warrior Shrine. In Arkham Asylum, Killer Croc had so much presence. Like, when he was in the room at the beginning of the game, like, it was unnerving. And obviously that doesn't translate into the movie because it's a normal dude in makeup.
Right.
I would have sort of liked the sort of feral, like, huge, like, room-filling...
Right, right.
Like, low bass voice, you know, that just like, oh my god, get that thing away from me.
Like a Grint, I don't get that, you know, anymore. Like a big character. They could have gone a CGI direction with it, and if it was done well, they could have had it kind of like act like a Groot character to a degree.
I don't know if audiences would have bought it. Because, like, a really feral character who's very large and can just tear everyone apart in a millisecond.
Right, right.
I don't think they would have bought the fact that this guy's going to be a team player, so
sure,
I see why they did it.
Right. I don't know, but yeah, it looks good. I have high hopes for that. I mean, I'm not getting my hopes or excite, like, you know, my expectations super high up. I'm still keeping them reasonable, so that way I go in and hopefully enjoy it. I'm sure I'll enjoy it. I usually do enjoy most of these movies, and I have high hopes that it will be everything it needs to be. It doesn't have to be the most amazing movie or well-written movie ever. It just has to be a lot of fun, like Guardians was, and have the audience have a good time. Show that the characters are having a good time, and I think that'll be enough to make it, you know, it's going to have the Joker, it'll have an appearance from Batman, so it still has some selling power to it, because people will want to go see the new Joker and stuff like that, so it's not completely out on its feet, you know, in the dark with no big characters in it. It's got some big name characters in it, obviously. So I hope it does well. I hope it sells well. I hope it gets, you know, at least like a C plus or a B minus would be nice. But as long as it does that well and it's a decent movie, then I'll be excited for hopefully DC giving other movies more faith.
I have heard, and again, this is all secondhand from my friends. I don't know how true this is. When you mentioned, like, everyone on set's having a good time, they feel like they're in their 20s again, I've heard that Jared Leto is, like, making some of the creators nervous with some of his method acting. Is there any truth to that?
I read an article about that, actually, just a couple days ago, and I don't know, it was weird. He would say, like, weird things and would do weird things during the filming of it, and who knows? I mean, was it Margot Robbie gave the Joker, or did Joker give Margot Robbie? Somebody gave somebody like a dead rat for their... I think the Joker gave Margot or Harley a dead rat during her birthday or something. I feel like that was the case. I'm pretty sure that was what... Who knows? He's getting into character. He's doing super method acting, but that's probably what that dude's all about. I mean, so is Heath Ledger. So is Christian Bale. They're all method actors that get super crazy into character.
Tom Hardy even.
Yeah, Tom Hardy is. They're all super, like, they will dedicate their entire life and body to the character. And there's nothing wrong with that, as long as you don't, like, overdose on pills and shit, which wasn't even necessarily 100% attributed to Heath playing the Joker. He just fucking got either bad advice from doctors of taking two different types of medicine, or whatever the hell the case was there. It's not like fucking he was just overdosing on fucking cocaine because of the Joker or anything. It's just... he was taking wrong prescriptions that shouldn't have been taken together, or whatever the hell it was.
It was sleep pills, I believe, that took him out, right?
Yeah, it was like sleep pills mixed with some prescription that shouldn't have been mixed. Like I said, it wasn't like hardcore drugs that he was just overdosing on. He was just taking bad prescriptions together. So I don't see any problem with method acting in that fashion. I think, you know, more power to him if they get super into character. And if he churns out a good performance, then he knows what's at stake. He knows what he has to live up to. He knows he has to live up to, like, the likes of Jack Nicholson and Heath Ledger, who, you know, have really set the bar so damn high. So it's likely he won't surpass that, but nobody thought Heath stood a chance compared to Jack Nicholson, and he... and some people's minds surpassed him, and other people's not so much, but most people think he did a great job regardless, so... yeah, I think he'll do well.
I don't think Jack Nicholson was a tough act to beat. Not because his performance wasn't good. His performance was stellar. It was amazing. But Jack Nicholson incorporates himself into all of his roles.
Right.
So there's a signature there that isn't... like, the Joker, Jack Nicholson, and the Shining, Jack Nicholson, are basically the same character... tailored a little differently. Right. And it works. Like, Nicolas Cage did that back when he was still a good actor. He puts himself into the character as opposed to, you know, putting the character, you know, as sort of a cloak around himself, you know?
Sure, sure.
It's almost the exact opposite of method acting.
Right.
And, you know, it would be interesting on the Dark Knight Rises set, because if both Tom Hardy is a method actor and Christian Bale, from what I understand, is a method actor.
Yes, he's very method.
What happens when those two dudes run into each other in the coffee room? Do they have to, like, fucking... do they taunt each other?
I don't know.
That would be interesting. I'd be curious about that. But, yeah, because I know Charlize Theron almost lost her mind working with Tom Hardy on the Mad Max set. Like, she was losing it. The stress was, like...
yeah, but that was a lot of factors. I read articles on that, and there's a lot of factors that led into it. They don't hate each other or have any beef with each other. But, yeah, they just kind of bumped elbows because it's fucking... you're in the desert filming... and it's rough filming for several days. They went over their shooting schedule, if I remember correctly. They're in the dead heat. They're all dirty and grimy. And fucking hanging off cars and all that shit, because a lot of that was legitimate. It was all practical effects for the most part, other than, you know, some included explosions and additional cars in the background and some mountains and stuff like that. But, you know, Tom Hardy really hung off a car and shit like that, strapped in, of course. But it's just, there's a lot of stuff like that. So, yeah, I could imagine people getting on each other's nerves in that case, but...
Well, it was also, there was no script, so for an actress, that's, or an actor, anyone, that's very stressful. That's incredibly stressful, you know? So,
yeah, they said they both have respect for each other, and they don't have any, like, hatred towards each other. But yeah, they definitely bumped heads, but that's understandable in those kind of conditions, but yeah. Especially method actors, yeah. Method actors do have a way of rubbing people the wrong way, because they take it so damn seriously, because they literally dedicate themselves to the role. Fucking Christian Slater, oh my god. Christian Bale.
I don't think that's weird. That's
no, perfectly normal. No, there's nothing wrong. There's nothing wrong with Christian Slater, but talking about Christian Bale, and he's like, if he lost ridiculous amount of weight for The Machinist, I never did see that movie. Did you see that movie?
I did not. I will, but I did not.
He's like a skeleton in that movie, and that's no exaggeration. I haven't seen it, but I've heard about it, and I've seen pictures from it. And he's literally like, you can see his ribcage full on in the pictures, and his wrists just look fucking grossly underweight. He went from that to Batman Begins, where he bulked up a ton, and he put on a ton of weight. Like, I think he put on like 80 pounds or something crazy for that role. And then he had to drop it for The Fighter, which was a good movie with him and Mark Wahlberg. Yeah, where he played a crack addict. And then he had to put it back on for Dark Knight Rises, I think. I think that was the order, because that was between Dark Knight and Dark Knight Rises, if I'm not mistaken. He's just bouncing all over the place, this dude. And he obviously had Terminator in there somewhere. And yeah, but yeah, he's super method actor. So anyways... Well, I was just saying, it looks good, and yeah, I think Leto will do great. I think Harley Quinn's going to be great. I think most of the actors will be great, and I think it'll be a fun movie. I just hope it's not, I don't know, I hope it's not bogged down by anything stupid, but I don't think it will. I at least hope not.
I mean, if I'm not bored, it passes. I mean, it's easy. Just as long as I'm not bored... and I'm having fun, that's fine. You know, even if I am bored, if I feel like they did a lot of smart stuff and they wrote a really sophisticated story, boredom is okay. There was a movie I was actually a little bored with, but I still thought it was really good recently, and I can't remember which movie that was. All right. I was going to say Bridge of Spies, but that was not a boring movie. That was just a really good movie.
This was informational.
No, it was substantial.
All right, well, let's move on to comics and in general, and you want to start? Let's start with Blackest Night.
I'm curious. Let's say real quick, the Blackest Night is, I've technically read half of it, because the Blackest Night itself is a... Razor said it really, really well. It's a blockbuster format.
Sure.
So to fill in the blanks, you got to read Green Lantern Solo Series, which I have not done yet. I didn't
read that either, but I still enjoyed Blackest Night by itself.
Well, it's kind of... Oh, and here's another thing we should talk about. Spoilers. We're going to get into spoilers, guys. Yes,
spoilers. That should be a given. We'll probably warn you better when there's not spoilers than when there are spoilers.
And when people get spoiled without warning, they have every right to be angry. So I don't want to do that.
Sure. We'll try and be more cognizant going forward. But yes, full spoilers for these comics we're discussing.
Especially for The Long Halloween. The Long Halloween is a noir story.
Sure.
It works because you don't know what's going to happen.
Exactly.
That's every noir story.
So if you're super interested, and the whole point of why we're doing this, one is because we want to discuss them with each other, and we want you guys to hear about it, but also... we're hoping you'll check out these comics too. If we can get more people involved in reading comics and getting super involved in these characters going into Injustice, to me that's a job well done. So
maybe definitely check out with that then. Before we even get to the story itself, you know, maybe a good little blurb on why you should read it, you know? And if I want to say Blackest Night is an ensemble comic book. It has everyone's in it. if you have, if your favorite characters are among the Justice League and then some lesser known characters,
right,
and you get to, you want to see them interact, you will get that in a very big way. I also feel like it does, without saying too much, it's very clever on how it represents the personalities of the other characters, minor and larger characters, and makes those personality qualities relevant to the overall story. That is very interesting how they do that. So, do you want to add on anything to that? Is there any little...
I'm going to read the synopsis of the book. I have it here, right here. I'm going to just read it. So, I mean, so if this is no spoilers. This is just the synopsis to get people interested. But we will go into full spoilers. It's been a long time since I've read it, so I'm going to need you, obviously, to remind me of a lot of these things. But once you say things, I'll remember them. But I know what I loved about it. But here's what they wrote on the cover of the book. I think. like, it is on the cover of the book, but I don't know if it's necessarily a synopsis. We'll see. But I doubt it's any spoilers because it's on the back of it, so I don't think they would do anything like that. But anyways, the dead will rise. Across thousands of worlds, the dead have risen. These Black Lanterns, heroes and villains recruited from beyond the grave, have one purpose: extinguish all lights and life in the universe. Hal Jordan has overcome death once before. As the greatest Green Lantern to ever wield the Emerald Ring, it is Hal's unquestioned duty to lead the living against this overwhelming army of death. While Blackest Night consumes Earth's heroes, the Seven Corps, empowered by emotional spectrum, must end their war against each other or bear witness to the end of all creation. Each of these wildly different corps, fueled by rage, avarice, fear, will, hope, compassion, and love, must unite against the Black Lanterns, but only those whose light shines the brightest can lift the shadows cast by Black Hand and his followers. As Earth becomes the ultimate battleground between the living and the dead, there's only one certainty: no one escapes death. So, all the lanterns, you know, your green, your star sapphires, your blues, your reds, your yellows, etc., they all have to come together to fight off the Black Lanterns, which are all about death and bringing people back to life. So you see a lot of dead heroes come back to life as zombies, essentially, fighting for the Black Hand and Necron, etc., and it gets really intense. So it's got some great character interactions and all that, but that's probably where the non-spoiler talk will end, and we will be getting into full spoilers right now. So check it out. You can find it for like $10 on Amazon, somewhere around there. It's just called Blackest Night. And then the companion one, if you want like all the side intricate stuff in between, kind of all the stuff to give further backstory on everything of what's going on, is called Green Lantern Blackest Night. Anyways, on to spoiler talk. Sir Temp, what did you think about this? And let's kind of dive into this and tear it apart, because like I said, it's been a while. This is about... I read this before Injustice 1 came out, when I was getting into all these comics and reading a bunch of shit. So, tell me what you thought.
I thought it... Well, I first of all, I thought it was very good. But I went in with a couple of reservations. The first one being that it's no secret that I am very zombied out. Incredibly sure. Zombied out. Zombies don't do a lot for me. Even when I did like zombies a lot, their appeal was in sort of the overwhelming, unescapable nature of them. The zombie itself is not terribly interesting to me. It's not a character, it's a device. But it worked. It worked really well in Blackest Night. Because the further you get into the comic, the less they feel like zombies and the more they feel like phantoms.
Right.
They feel like heralds of a very dark force. They feel like extensions of another entity. Which, I mean, they are. That's exactly what they are. And that made it a lot of fun for me. I also like the emotional dilemma of the zombie where, you know, this was one of my loved ones. I don't want to kill them. Right. And they put an interesting spin on that, where they choose to kill their loved ones, and sort of, kind of. And their loved ones, they had to do it over and over again because their loved ones are unkillable. They just reassemble due to the Black Lantern.
Right.
Power, whatever. So that's a very interesting. You have to kill your loved ones over and over and over again. That's very fascinating.
There's definitely some good character interactions. I believe, if I can recall right, isn't Hawkman alive but Hawkgirl's dead?
No, they're both alive in the beginning.
Okay, and then eventually one... Does one of them die or do both of them die? I can't remember, but I know one of them has to...
They both die.
They have to... I think it's Hawkman has to interact with a dead hot girl. Is that correct? I can't remember. No, like I said,
I
it's been a while.
I don't believe so, because they both get killed at the same time when Adam's on the phone with them.
Yeah, I see it.
Yeah.
Gotcha.
It is very interesting how that's handled, though. There's a character who's seems very important. I feel like the one thing that was sort of deprived of my reading experience is I had no idea who Jean was.
Jean?
And Jean.
Just Jean.
Adam has a very clear relationship with her.
Oh, okay.
We know she's done horrible, horrible things.
Gotcha.
But I don't know more than that. And you're never really told more than that. You eventually run into a dead Jean.
Right.
But I...
Yeah, there's a few of that kind of stuff. Yeah, then talking about... former characters and whatnot.
But her name
is...
Oh, bless you.
We're good. I'm alive.
You made it. Yeah, that name kept coming up over and over again, and I feel like I was missing a bit of context. But yeah, I mean...
Jean Grey. Jean.
I mean, that's not far off. I mean, you know that Adam has some sort of intimacy with Jean. You know Hawkman and Hawkgirl don't really like Jean. You know Flash knows Jean's not good. But you know that's all you ever get until she shows up. And you still don't really know that much about her. So I'm sure I missed something on that. But it's interesting. It's a Green Lantern comic, but the main character is pretty much Flash. Flash is the main character.
Right.
So it seems to me. Was that your observation?
Yeah, to a degree. Between him and Hal, it kind of bounces back and forth. But yeah, they're definitely the two that get the most limelight, so to speak, or most attention.
And Hal disappears for a while, because... he's gathering the cores, which honestly is great. Like, watching all the cores hang out together is so much fun.
Oh, yeah. Their interactions are tremendous. And that's why this is such a fascinating, story arc or graphic novel or story or whatever you want to call it, is you're having people that are normally at each other's, you know, necks having to work together, which is always fun, in my opinion. It's fun when it's not done often, but when it's done rarely, I like seeing... enemies, bitter enemies, come together for a cause and have to work towards something, bickering while they do it. I mean, that's kind of why in MK Deception's intro, I like the idea of Raiden, Quan Chi, and Shang Tsung fighting each other to the death, and all of a sudden they have to work together to fight off the Dragon King, just to go back to fighting again if they do defeat the Dragon King, which is hilarious to me. It's like, let's stop fighting for a second, kill this guy, and then let's go back to killing each other. Like, it's like, instead of all of us dying, let's make sure he's dead, and that way only one of us, at least one of us, can live. I like that idea and that mindset. And that's kind of what they're doing here, but the personalities are so different because of, you know, the spectrums that they, you know, represent, the emotional spectrums they represent.
I love it when reason wins the day. That always makes me so happy. And that's what you just mentioned is a huge staple of anime. That's one thing I love about anime is you see unlike figures having to work together in circumstances. I love that. I just adore that. And I mean, I was reading Green Lantern back when Injustice was about to come out. And that one takes place after Blackest Night. And it's basically a buddy cop show with Green Lantern and Sinestro. And I love those two hanging out together. They're so much fun. Sinestro had a very good showing. I mean, that's a category I want to do after we're done discussing Blackest Night of who had a really good showing. I want to do that with a long Halloween as well.
Real quick.
Yes.
Did this book change what's your favorite Lantern group coming out of this?
Oh, man, I think just in terms of power sets, the most interesting is Blue, and that hasn't changed. My favorite Lantern of all time has always been Sinestro. So technically nothing has changed at all.
Okay.
Maybe one Lantern group that went up quite a bit in my book was the Reds.
The Reds?
Because I thought making Mera a Red Lantern was brilliant. And dramatically, it worked so well.
All the deputized Lanterns were brilliant choices, in my opinion. Like, totally... Having the Flash be the blue one just makes sense, given, you know, the whole story that's being told leading up to that. And Scarecrow is an amazing choice. I mean, come on, that's out of all the fearful things, the whole guy that's all about inflicting fear just makes sense.
I half agree. I absolutely agree with you on Scarecrow. And you're not wrong about Flash. I think there was a better choice. We'll get into that when we do who had a good showing.
Right.
I'll definitely go further into that. But they're all good choices. Yes, you're correct about that. I feel like they didn't do enough with Wonder Woman. Wonder Woman felt like a huge waste. I feel like after they deputized her, we never saw her again.
Right.
And what compounds the problem is Wonder Woman in a Star Sapphire suit looks exactly like Star Sapphire from a distance. Like, I could not tell them apart. So it took a lot of the punch out. Yeah, Wonder Woman, if we're talking about bad showings, Wonder Woman, I feel like she was barely in this comic, like, at all. I feel like she did nothing.
Yeah, it wasn't really her showing or her time to shine, I guess. Yeah, I agree with that. I was going to list her as the least exciting choice out of all of those. And I like Wonder Woman quite a bit. She's one of my favorite characters. She easily makes the top 15, maybe even top 10. I'm a big fan of Wonder Woman, but yeah, she did not... She was just kind of background for a lot of it.
Yeah, no, and but Mara had a fantastic showing. As a Red Lantern was... Because she's already... I mean, I'm reading Aquaman right now, and she's always pissed. And it's really a great character trait. Like, I know women like that, you know, who do get pissed off very easily. You know, they kind of have a resting bitch face, but they're great people, and they're a lot of fun to be around because they don't take any shit, you know? And I see a couple of my friends a lot in Mara. And so she's a lot of fun to read. I feel like that they really pronounced that character trait because when she faces her loved ones coming back from the dead and trying to kill her, I feel like she handled it better than almost everybody. Like, she took it like a champ. Like, she's a fucking soldier. You know? Adam took it the worst, but that's part of his character. He's compassionate, you know? So that empathy all kind of, and that sympathy all kind of surfaces, you know? So he struggled with it the most, but that's fine. That's not my criticism of the Adam. It's good character writing, you know? I thought they really did justice for Mara in this comic.
Yeah, I gotta read this again. I've been, like, looking through it as we're talking, just kind of, and it's like, it's funny because before Injustice, I was a fan, and I read some comics. I wasn't, like, I was huge into superheroes, but I hadn't read a lot of comics. But since Injustice, I've read a lot more comics, obviously, because it's been several years since I've gotten into comics. And also, I play a game that I've talked about, Heroescape, almost every single weekend. And in that game, we've expanded to over, like, 600 characters at this point. It's ridiculous. And each character has their own card with specials and stats and stuff. And I usually research them and kind of get to know them. And it's like, my knowledge on characters from Marvel, DC, and Independent to a degree has gone up substantially. I know 1,000 times more about the characters and who certain people are and what they're all about. So it's like, I feel like I would enjoy this book even more so knowing who all these characters are. Because there's, like you said, it's just a who's who of fucking the DC universe in this book. And going through it right now, just kind of skimming through it, and I see certain characters that I'm like, back then I probably wouldn't have known much about them, so I probably wouldn't have appreciated so much seeing them, but now it's like, seeing Spectre in here, and seeing the Phantom Stranger, seeing all these characters interact, that's tremendous. I should read it again.
It was a lot of fun, and I'll be honest with you, when I first started reading the comic, I was not feeling the first third of it. Because the first third is a lot of narrating from Hal Jordan.
Right.
Hal Jordan's not super well spoken. He's not the smartest dude. And so he's kind of doing the whole, like, Top Gun personality narrating. It's not bad, but it's not super interesting. And it doesn't help that I don't know a lot about the Green Lanterns in general, even though that's probably the only series I read when Injustice was coming out. I think a lot of the things Razor says about Hal Jordan are true. He's kind of a dumb white idiot. Like, that's sort of his thing. Like, and there's nothing wrong with that. It's, you know, some, you know, there's, you know, good old boys out there who just want to fight the bad guy and punch the shithole and, you know, and go home and eat steak. Like, that's their thing, you know? That is sort of Hal Jordan. Maybe that changes. Maybe I have not been properly acquainted to Hal Jordan, but that's why I'm reading these comics. The Flash is much better, I think, as a central character, because he's much more human. He's a far more down-to-earth superhero. You know, Well, like, Superman is somewhat good at that too, but Superman's is a Kansas redneck, kind of. He's sort of right. Like a farm boy, which makes him so interesting in terms of how he interacts with everyone and how, like, you know, wholesome he is. But the Flash is, like, someone you can hang out and have a beer with. That's the Flash.
Sure, sure.
So making him a central character was very smart. Great plot device. I mean, the Flash is what makes this whole story work, is the fact that he utilizes his speed to make the plot happen. Very important. I don't know how they would have done this without the Flash. Even Hawk Girl and Hawkman were very interesting, I thought. You know, I don't know much about those characters, but I know Hawk Girl very well from the Justice League cartoon.
Right.
Which I still need to finish, by the way.
It's great stuff.
It's really good.
I would like to discuss those at some point along this journey. Hopefully, like I said, if they do announce a new Injustice game, it's going to give us all the more reason, because I would like to discuss both Batman the Animated Series and the Justice League cartoons, and maybe do like a weekly couple episode review type of thing.
Well, one thing to counter what Razor said about John from the Justice League, can't remember his last name right now,
John Stewart.
I think it was very smart putting John Stewart in instead of Hal Jordan, because when the Flash is already such a comical character, such a relief character, who's always like doing one-liners and running around the place and making jokes and not or whatnot, it makes a lot more sense to have someone like John Stewart around, who's very serious, very focused, very work-driven. He's a good counter to that, you know?
Right.
I don't know if that would have worked as well with Hal Jordan, because we saw Hal Jordan in the Justice League movie Doom. And, I mean, it's different flavors of zany, for sure. But, yeah, no, I thought that was a good mix. I think a lot of people like Jon Stewart because he is the first Green Lantern they grew up with. Like, that is their first experience with Green Lantern. You know? No, it's just everyone's going to be attracted to different types of characters. I'm not really, honestly, despite all the praise I've given Flash, I'm not really much of a Michelangelo guy. I'm more of a Leonardo Donatello kind of guy, you know?
Yeah.
The party animal isn't really who I gravitate towards in a series or a movie. You know, that's going to be different for everybody.
Right.
Where was I going with that?
I have no idea.
But anyway, yeah, Justice League. Flash. We were talking about Flash.
Right.
Flash was a very good central character. I think another reason why he works so well is because I think he's so well networked. He has a very strong, in-depth relationship with most of the main cast, you know? And when he doesn't, they work it in his advantage. I don't think Mara and Flash know each other that well. They act like they don't know each other that well, and that makes for better conversations, you know? And I mean, he clearly has a great rapport with Adam. So when Adam, Mara, and Flash are all there, you have really, really good conversational dynamics. Some characters I did not recognize, but I don't even have a visual for him, like Deadman. Are you familiar with Deadman?
Yeah, I know who he is. He's part of the Justice League Dark, along with like Zatanna, Constantine. Who else are regular members there? I'm trying to think. Phantom Strangers cross with them at some points. Swamp Things cross with them. Frankenstein's even cross with them at some points. But yeah, it's mainly consists of Constantine, Zatanna, Deadman are prominent members. And then there's a dude, I can't remember. It's like, I'm trying to remember his name. It's like the M or something. I can't remember the other dude, but yeah, he's one of them. He's like an acrobatic kind of like a Nightwing, but he died and now he's kind of like an undead type of ghostly figure, but he can possess other people's body and take control of him. He's been in one of the Justice League cartoons. I remember that for sure.
Well, here's the confusing part. When he talks, it's almost like he has like a California surfer lingo thing going on. So I'm kind of picturing like Howie Mandel from Little Monsters every time he has dialogue. And then I Google him and he looks like Ben Kingsley dressed as Iron Fist. And I'm like, what the fuck is going on? What are they going for with this character? I don't know what to think anymore, but he was a lot of fun. Again, very well utilized. Very, very right. Well utilized.
Yeah, yeah.
So, and I guess if I had to summarize my thoughts on The Blackest Night, I love seeing the chorus come together. I think Flash was a very good central protagonist. For the most part, maybe with Wonder Woman being the exception, I thought everyone was well integrated. Good showing from the Atom.
a character I don't know much about, but I've already kind of fallen in love with. I relate to the Atom a lot. Like, I see a little sprinkles of my own personality in the Atom. Because he's just very laid back, very chill, nice guy. I'm just pumping myself up right now. I should probably stop doing that.
Yeah.
No, just really. Okay, let me rephrase. I can relate to the Atom.
Sure.
I get this guy.
Right.
Do you have any final thoughts on Blackest Night before we do best showing, worst showing?
I think my thoughts of it were, it wasn't my favorite book. I mean, it was enjoyable. If we were to rate it, which I think we should, just we'll start kind of a trend going on here. And I actually want to start. I want to start a trend of doing, since our show is only going to be, you know, maybe every 2 weeks, then of course there will be another cast in between there. And maybe once we get closer to the, you know, leading up to the next game, if that does end up being the case, which I hope it does at this point. I'd be kind of disappointed if that's not, because I'm full on into like expecting Injustice and wanting it to be, because I kind of want to delve into all of that. I think it'd be a lot of fun. What I would like to do is each week, or each episode, I should say, recommend a book. Obviously not the one we're reviewing. I'm hoping, what I would like to do going forward, seeing as this is the first episode, I would like to recommend a book for people to read, us to read. Like, we'll say, by next episode, we're both going to finish Aquaman Volume 1. We'll say that. Hopefully other people will find a way to, you know, whether you get it off Amazon or you do it illegally, I don't care. I'm not condoning anything. Do whatever you got to do. Read the book. Obviously, I recommend purchasing it off Amazon. I mean, it's only like $10 for most of these things. Not a whole lot when you're getting 7 comics worth, so it's pretty decent.
And a lot of them are older now. A lot of these have been out since, you know, last 3 or 4 years.
Oh, yeah. You can find them cheap on Amazon, so there's really no reason not to fork over the $10, especially if Amazon Prime, you get there in 2 days, and then you read it. And that way, come the next episode, we'll review it, and you guys can kind of discuss it in the comments, and then maybe we'll get some guests on that have read it as well, and we'll kind of discuss it with them. So that would be my ideal way to go forward, is each episode do a recommended comic to read, a graphic novel. There's so many out there through history. I mean, we can go all the way back to, you know, the beginning of the comics themselves, in the most case with a lot of these characters, because there's so many great stories to be told. A lot of them are more recent, like from the 70s and till now, but still, there's a lot of ones that you can get for relatively cheap that I would like to discuss. And it would also push me to read a lot of things I haven't, but there's certain ones that I have read that I wouldn't mind reading again for us to discuss it. So people will kind of join you in the journey of reading a lot of these things. So that way, when we discuss this, people will hopefully have it freshly in their mind so they can kind of chip in as well. So that's what I'm looking forward to doing. But anyways, reviewing these ones. Blackest Night, final thoughts for me is I enjoyed it immensely. For I'm a big Lantern fan. I love Green Lanterns. I love the Blue Lanterns. Those are my top two favorite of the Lantern group. I like them all for their own individual reason. Larfleet's hilarious.
Oh yes, he's
fantastic. I love the orange Lantern oath. I gotta pull it up real quick because I can't remember how it is. It's something. What's yours is mine. What's mine is mine. And blah blah blah. But let's I gotta bring it up because it's hilarious, but I like Larfleeze. He's a lot of fun.
It was cheesy, but it was really cool when all the cores game up for battle and they all shout their mantra. I thought that was very, very cheesy, but still very powerful, very moving. I thought that was good.
Yes. I agree. the funny thing is about the Orange Lanterns is, there can only ever be one Orange Lantern because they're so greedy that they want each other's rings. Like, that's what's so great about it, is there can never be two, because there can never be like a group of Orange Lanterns, because they're just far too greedy to let anybody else have power beyond themselves. So
they're very likably greedy too, at least Lafreeze's. Because he has insatiable hunger that Indigo One points out, and she's like, no, it's not his fault that he's hungry all the time. He's an Orange Lantern, and St. Walker's like, oh, I can help you with that. I can satiate your hunger, and I don't remember exactly what he says, but when St. Walker does that, his response is something along the lines of, "Huh, that did work.
you know what, you're all right.
Yeah,
it's almost whimsical. It's very effective.
Yes. Okay, his is, what's mine is mine, and mine and mine, and mine and mine and mine, not yours. Like, that's just fucking great.
You know what's funny? He doesn't shout his mantra because he's too busy doing something in the background. He's the only one who doesn't shout it.
But no, I mean, he's just filled with great characters, and I love Blackest Night. I love individual stories centered on a specific character, and those can oftentimes are the best stories. But in terms of getting all the characters together for a big event like this, so great. And it's a lot of fun to see all these characters come together and interact that you may not usually see interact in that way. You get a lot of fun. It's kind of like how the Avengers movies are fun because of the character interactions. These comic books, like these types of stories are like that. And you get that with Blackest Night. I love the Lantern Corps. And just like Razor said for Injustice, his ideal... I can't remember. I think it was him that said his ideal bad guy for like the main villain. Yes. Did he say Anti-Monitor or did, cause I could have sworn.
Razor said as his number 7 Anti-Monitor.
Someone also suggested that they do Necron and Black Hand as the main villains.
He suggested it, but he did not pick Black Hand. Shadaloo picked Black Hand.
Right, right. And maybe it was Shadaloo that was suggesting that he be the villain. And somebody was suggesting that you have Black Hand be the sub boss, kind of like a Goro, and then Necron be the main boss. And I think that would work really, really well.
No, so, absolutely. That would be a great fighting game.
Yeah, sure. Yeah. And then it would give you more reason to put, you know, each of the Lantern groups, and then you could have some fun different characters, and you could have Black Hand and Necron bringing up dead versions of characters that didn't make the game as for like a special power. So that'd be really
interesting. Yeah, it's like Heralds, like Marvel vs. Capcom 3
right,
style.
Right.
And it would be. Oh, dude, in the fucking final stage, the Black Lantern's in the background just flashing and shit,
dude.
And like next to it is the White Lantern.
That like, would be badass. That would be badass.
And fucking like Anti-Monitor's like peeking out like Dan Forden style with the Black Lantern. Like, that'd be so sick, dude.
Yeah, it would be badass. That would be definitely bad. Anti-Monitor has been a Black Lantern at one point, and he's also been a Yellow Lantern, if I'm not mistaken. But yeah, so, yeah, I would like to see that. I think that would be a really cool fighting game, and it would help separate itself from, rather than going flat out like Darkseid as the villain, I think doing the Lantern approach would be really interesting and fun.
But yeah, no. I don't want to see Darkseid as the villain. I do like Darkseid, but I like Darkseid.
I agree.
When he's being like a diplomat and a bit of an asshole at the same time, right, and he's trying to talk down Superman, that's when Darkseid works for me. I don't think he's as effective as a big bad.
Right, I agree with you. He's fun as a character, but yeah, I wouldn't want him to be the main big bad. But no, other closing thoughts is just it's a fun book. It's not going to be the most amazing thing you've ever read, but it's action-y and it's fun, and you get to see a lot of characters. So if you want to see a lot of characters interact and a lot of characters, a lot of action, this is that book. And it's really cool. If you want to get into the Lanterns, this is definitely a good way to do it. You get to see a lot of them interact and what they're all about type of thing. And it might be kind of like a doorway to leading to, you know, wanting to read the individual books of the Lanterns, etc. So... yeah, I definitely recommend it. I would give it, I'd probably give it a 8 out of 10, 8.5 out of 10, somewhere around there. It was enjoyable.
I'd give it a 7.5.
But yeah, no, I don't have any more thoughts. And you wanted to talk about who stood out the most, who kind of like shined the most? Yeah, just
great showings. I have three. The first one we'll do is the Atom. The Atom had a fantastic showing.
Yes.
If you don't know who the Atom is, I mean, this was a fantastic way to meet him. I don't even really care about his powers. I mean, his powers are very interesting. I like how you can, like, run through phone lines. I think that's
sure. It's like, cool. If you know who Ant-Man is in Marvel because of the movie now, or you've read Marvel comics and you're not that into DC, Atom is essentially the equivalent. And we're not going to sit there and do the who came first type of thing. Atom is the equivalent of the DC universe. And yes, he has a lot of the same type of abilities. He's not like leading ants or anything like that, but in terms of size manipulation and, you know, shrinking down, etc., yes, he can do, and he can do the phone thing, which is really cool. One of his things is he'd call people and then he'd call somebody up and then just zip right through the lines and come out the other side and just meet them there. That's a really cool mechanic. It's almost like the Matrix. So yeah, there's a lot of fun aspects. He was in Batman the Brave and the Bold cartoon a lot, and yeah, he's a lot of fun.
But I believe Adam was first by about a year.
Okay.
I think. Probably. But again, I didn't know who he was, and he's probably my second or third favorite character in the Blackest Night. I thought he was awesome. That's obvious, though. I kind of hinted at that.
Right.
I don't think I hinted at this. I think another character who had a great, great showing was Damage. Damage was fantastic in this comic. And this kind of goes full circle to what I was talking about earlier. I was kind of disappointed Flash was the Blue Lantern because I wanted it to be Damage. I was really hoping Damage would be the Blue Lantern. Because what the comic does is every time a character demonstrates like a personality trait
right.
that is in line with one of the lanterns, it shows them through a lens of like blue or violet. And like when the Flash is trying to like, you know, talk Damage's morale up and say, hey, we got to do this. You know, you can't despair now. We have to hang together.
Right.
You know, the whole panel goes blue and Damage is like, you're right, let's do this. And it says in subtitles, Blue Lantern. I'm like, oh, that's sick. That is fucking well done.
Right.
Yeah, I guess the third showing, nothing really big, no big surprise here. Mara. I thought Mara was a lot of fun.
You know? Yes, definitely. She was really cool in this comic, definitely.
I mean, worst showing is Wonder Woman, but it's almost not even worth talking about, but yeah.
Well, right. I'm just saying the whole playing off with Mara with Aquaman being dead, I thought was really, really good. Her being obviously pissed off, for, which is reasonable.
Yeah, and I guess we'll throw, if we had to pull a fourth, I'm going to say Sinestro, you know, taking the White Lantern powers for himself. Right. I mean, Sinestro's a very interesting character. He's not evil. He's a very morbid type of good. He's a very morbid, broken version of a good guy. I think that's really fascinating.
Right.
I really think one reason why people don't like fucking Sinestro is just because he's very Hitler-esque in his appearance. But even said that the character writing for Sinestro is Hitler-inspired, he's nothing like Hitler. Hitler was not a misunderstood guy with good intentions who did horrible things. That is not fucking Hitler. Hitler was a monster, and he knew he was a monster. Sinestro, at least in his brain. And also the kind of hint at experiences he's had that kind of shape him the way he is. A very interesting character, in my opinion. That's everything I got in Blackest Night. I'm sure there's more, but nothing's coming to mind. Well, I just like the whole, you know, Lord of the Rings Two Towers when everything looks shitty and looks like they're going to lose, and then all the lanterns across the galaxy fucking show up. That's really sick. I like that a lot.
Yeah.
Little moments like that. Like, that's why I said Razor said it best. It's a blockbuster, and I thought that was well handled.
What'd you think about Black Lantern Batman?
He was not in it that much, actually.
No, he wasn't.
Well, they kind of hint at the fact that that Batman kind of did some plot armor shit where he, like, exploded so he couldn't hurt me, but it wasn't clear. Like, maybe they'll answer that question later.
Right.
But Batman never attacks anyone. He just explodes, implying he was doing Batman stuff, you know? And I'm like, I would like to know what that is, but I guess I have to read Brightest Day to find out. I won't know.
Right.
Interesting, though, yeah.
All right, well, that covers that. But yeah, it's just really fun. I've been looking through the panels as we've been talking and just seeing so many, like, just even characters that didn't really play a role in the thing. They just having a cameo appearance as their dead selves, and just really fun. Like, even Copperhead's in here. It's like, you just see a giant snake, snake-like helmets or whatever you want to call that mask on somebody, one of the dead people. It's just good stuff, but yeah.
Yeah, I remember Copperhead. I didn't know his name, but I remember seeing him, yeah.
Yeah. All right, well, let's move on to Long Halloween, which I regard as the comic that got me into comics. I think it came out in around 2008 or 2005, somewhere around there, I think, is when it was released, so it's not that old.
No, I think it's from the early 90s, right?
Are you sure? Let's check.
No, I'm not. Let's find out.
It's possible. I may be going off when it was republished. Let's see. Long Halloween.
Okay, we were it was somewhere in between what we said.
96 and 97. Yeah.
So that's interesting. It does look 90s when you read it.
Like, yeah,
it does
yeah,
have a very 90s vibe.
Yeah, I think mine's a republished version from, let's see. I'm not seeing a date on it. I think it was from 2000. Mine's probably the 2005, 2008 edition where it got republished or whatever. But because well, I know it is for a fact because it has some, it's got like some quotes and stuff, an interview with David Goyer and Chris Nolan in the front type of thing. So it was after, it was probably around The Dark Knight when that mine came out. But yeah, so that's cool. But all right, before we get into spoilers, to kind of give you a breakdown, because there's no rundown of this in the back of it, like for Darkest Night, which, or Blackest Night, which was nice to have to help kind of give you an idea. But just kind of giving you an idea, summing up myself, it would be, it's a whodunit, it's a mystery, it's very noir, like Brandon said, and it's very, the whole book, it's centered around holidays. So there's 12 issues all compiled into the book, and each issue is centered around a holiday. So it goes over the course of a year. And they came out monthly, so it was over the course, it was 13 issues, I guess, but it was in a monthly issue type of thing. And yes, they were all centered around a specific, you know, you cover like Valentine's Day, St. Patrick's Day, and all that kind of crap, I'm sure. I can't remember exactly, but you cover all the major ones for sure. And each holiday, a killing happens, and Batman's investigating with Gordon and all that, trying to figure out, and there's a lot of mob activity, a lot of, you know, crime lords going on, and then you also have a lot of appearances from all the Batman Rogues Gallery villains, and he's sort of going around questioning, trying to figure out who it is, and you get a lot of cameos by characters and a lot of interactions, even some outside of the Batman-specific Rogue Gallery, and Catwoman and stuff. They all play major parts, and it's really interesting. It's also a very big Harvey Dent kind of centered before he turns into Two-Face. So you get Harvey Dent as a lawyer or as a district attorney. So they're kind of the friendship playing off him, Gordon, and Bruce and Batman, etc. So there's a lot of that going on, but it's a very big mystery novel, and it's a real page turner, you know. You just gotta,
it is, for real.
It's one I had a hard time putting down. I read half of it in one sitting and then read the other half the next day or something like that. Or may have read
as
it all
I.
in one day.
I was
like,
the same way.
It was really, really good. Like, I just did not want to put it down, but it's a long one. It is 13 issues, so it takes a bit, but it took me a few hours, but it's good. So I definitely recommend it to anybody, and it really ends on a high note and really, really good, good at wrapping itself up. So I definitely recommend it to anybody. Like I said, I don't know if it's still my favorite comic of all time, but it's one that got me into it, so it kind of holds a special place in my heart. Obviously, being a big Batman fan, I enjoyed it all the more, and enjoying all the Batman villains. The only weird thing about it, or the only negative, is the art's a little weird, but you get used to it, I feel like.
There's times when Catwoman's face looks a little fucked up, without the mask.
Right, right. It's the art is odd. Just right from the get-go, it's insanely odd. Like, it's not like your traditional type of comic book art. But, you know, after a couple issues in, you get used to it. So it's not bad, per se. It's just different. But yeah, no, I can't recommend it enough. Definitely check it out. So now, when we get into spoilers, though, a big portion of why this book is so good is not knowing who it is and constantly guessing. Because they do a great job at pointing the finger at a few people throughout and bouncing back and forth between them until you finally figure out who it is in the end. So if you haven't read it, please stop the, and you want to read it. If you don't want to read it, then yeah, listen to us without reading it. That's fine. We'll break it down and kind of talk about it and go into all the spoiler goodness. But if you do want to read this, check it out. Get it and then come back to this episode and listen to our review of it, because I cannot recommend it enough, and it's not going to be as good if you know everything going into it.
I would say this, though. If you don't want to read it, really think about why you don't want to read it. Is it just because you're not really a comic book guy? Let me be the first to tell you, that's okay. I wasn't either. In a way, I still am not. I'm doing a lot of this to get ready for Injustice, and so I get to have a lot more substantial stuff to say when the game is announced, and we can talk more on the podcast, but That shouldn't matter. Don't let that stop you. It's very good. You do not need to be a comic book guy.
Yes, it's an easy read.
Precisely. If you're not a big Batman fan, again, do not let that stop you. There's so much more to the story than Batman. And this is the most detective-ish I've ever seen Batman be. The detective side of Batman's really well done in this comic. I haven't read a lot of comics, but I've never seen Batman portrayed this well in the detective role. Don't let that stop you. So, please.
Keep going. Yeah, I love Detective Batman, and that's one of my favorite. I love detectives. I love noir, and I'm all about that kind of old school, you know, 40s, 30s, 20s, 50s detective. So, I mean, that's a big part why I like Batman as a character, is the detective aspects of him, which aren't always played up. I mean, that's the one thing in, like, the Dark Knight movies I felt like was really missing. And I still love those movies, easily my favorite movies, but that was kind of downplayed a lot. The detective, he did some, but yeah, this is like classic detective type Batman, and it centers around Batman. There's no Robin, there's no giant cast of characters constantly, you know, that you're bouncing between. This is centered around Batman, his rogues gallery, but it's all about him being a detective, talking to Gordon, talking to Harvey, and trying to find out who this is. It is a detective novel, so to speak, featuring Batman. So
yeah, exactly. I mean, you hit it on the head with the Nolan reference, because you're right. No Batman movie has really done the detective Bruce Wayne Batman very well. Maybe the closest thing I can think of is Batman Returns. That kind of busted out the detective element a little more.
Right.
Because he's kind of in a cold war with the Penguin in that movie.
Sure.
FYI, I don't like that movie. I think there's only one good 90s Batman, that's the first one in my opinion.
In a lot of ways, I actually enjoy Returns more than 89.
Oh man, I won't go into it, dude, but that movie just kind of weird. It's such a weird ass fucking movie, and it's not that it's bad. Well, there are parts that are bad. Like there are parts I would just take out. Like I would take out the whole first 10 minutes, gone, if I was editing that movie.
Right.
Not one of my favorite movies, but I think it did Batman well. I think it did, like, the more technical Batman a little better. But just, I can't recommend this enough. Please read it. Don't spoil it because you're indifferent. Don't ruin it for yourself because you don't care. I promise you, you will not regret reading this. You know, I knew nothing. The only reason I read this is because it was on the top of Cyborg's recommendations. The only reason I read it. You know, it was, like, maybe 12th on my list. But Cyborg put his street cred on the line and said it was really, really good. I knew nothing about it. I didn't, honestly, Cyborg, when you told me to read it, I didn't even fucking know it was a Batman comic until I went to the Amazon.com page. You just said to read The Long Halloween. Right. I thought maybe it was like an origin story of Scarecrow at most. I had no idea it had anything to do with fucking Batman. But yeah, very good, very strong. But now it begins. Now we're going to start spoiling it. If you want it spoiled, I hope you reconsider. That's all I can really say about that.
Yes, and it's on Amazon right now. It's $14.86, and it's Prime and all that stuff. So you're going to get your money's worth. It is a big book. It's bigger than Blackest Night. It's 384 pages. It's 13 comics, combined. So all things considered, back then comics were probably, $1.50, $2 tops. So you're still getting your money's worth here, and yeah, it's really, really good, and it makes a lot of top 10 lists of Batman. I mean, that's where I first heard of it, is when I was first getting into comics. I'd search, and I still do this to this day, anytime I'm looking for the best stories for the characters, so I'm not just reading blindly, so to speak. I don't want to just throw my money around and get the things that, you know, aren't good, aren't worth putting my time and money into. Is this one was in a lot of top 10 lists that I read. So yes, definitely check it out. It's got 4.5 stars out of 469 reviews, so definitely check it out. But yes, we are going to get into spoilers now. So once again, as we've warned you, it's not going to be the same if you know who it is and what's going on. So this is your last warning. Definitely check it out one way or another, and then come back to this. Anyways, we can't warn you anymore. All right, let's get into this.
Well, to comment on the animation, there were some really weird animation moments, and I'm going to post one right now in the chat so you can see it, but this is one of Selena Kyle that just looks all sort of jacked up in the face, and it's one of the earliest panels in the comics, so I looked at that and I was like, ew.
Yeah, it's like Michael Jackson.
Yeah, it's pretty bad looking. There's like no nose, yeah. Like her eyes going so deep on the right eye that it's like there's almost like a hole there. Like, I know it's supposed to be her hair, but
right.
It doesn't look like that. It looks like a concave opening in her face. It just...
Yeah. Yeah, the art's a little wonky at times, but yeah, it's something you get used to, but yeah, it's interesting, but all that matters here is the story is great and the dialogue is great, but yes, let's dive into this now.
Yes.
All right. So... been a while, but trying to remember. Yes, I just turned to that page. It is right there, like towards the beginning. It's like page number. It's literally page. Let's see. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So it's number 7. So yeah, that's funny. Starts off with a great quote. I believe in Gotham City, and. That's a great quote to start off in. But yes, we covered a lot of it in the pre-spoiler stuff, but this book is just so tremendous at playing up the detective aspects, and you're constantly guessing. Did you have... I mean, let's be honest, both of us suspected who it would be in the end, but did you at least get fooled a couple of times like I did?
Yes, I did, but the comic kind of cheats on that aspect. You know, I might say the big reveal might be one of the weaker parts of this story, because the only hint you have of who it is, because honestly, from the first panel you see that character, I'm like, I bet it's him. They're emphasizing that character way too much. There's something up with this guy. The only hint you really have in the entire story that it's him, two hints, is that A, he tried to work with law enforcement in the past, and he had a hit on him by his father. There was a contract put on his head. That's hint number one. Hint number two, the coroner dies. Later on in the story, the coroner dies for no reason. Like, right. It's a complete breaking pattern. Those are the only two hints you have.
Well, you have the idea. I mean, you have the whole, you know who this character becomes type of thing going for it as well. You're going into this story knowing who Harvey Dent and Two-Face are.
Yeah.
So there's that. I mean, but yeah, I agree.
Well, that's
but...
why I thought it was Harvey Dent. And I didn't think it was Harvey Dent for a long time until I thought it was Harvey Dent, only to be slapped in the face that it wasn't Harvey Dent.
Exactly. Yeah. And that's kind of the fun aspect of... That's why this is such a fun book. They sold me. I mean, they got me. I thought it was going to be Two-Face several times, and then they throw, you know, they throw Calendar Man pulling strings. They throw the who was hiding in somebody's wall talking to him. Like, that's just fucking creepy. But that's awesome, because that's the best. Calendar Man is not in the A, B, or C list of Batman's rogues gallery. He has a huge gallery of a lot of good villains. Calendar Man is not amongst that list, but... They did him well in this book. They actually made him creepy. They made him fucking creepy and believable, you know. And they point the finger at I can't remember the mobster's son. I can't remember one of the crime lord's son. I can't remember his name. Do you remember?
I can't remember his name.
They point the fingers at him, and he's the one that Calendar Man is talking to from within the walls, and kind of, so that's why you buy that it could be the crime lord's son, you buy that it could be Calendar Man pulling the strings and all this stuff, you buy a couple of these people, and all the while Batman's just wondering who the hell is it, and the fingers being pointed at several different places, and yeah, it's just in the end it's just I don't know, like I said, it's just interesting. I love the play between Catwoman and Batman. I love that interaction between these two, and this is one of the best of it. This and Hush, they do it really well in Hush as well, and that's, I have a statue, like a $250 statue from Hush of a kiss they have in that comic that's really, really well made, and that's another good one for their interactions. But here it's really good too. I love this Catwoman. I love her outfit. I love the tail for her whip.
Yeah, Catwoman was a lot of fun in this one. I would say she was underrepresented, but from what I understand, there is a Catwoman series that corresponds with the Long Halloween that shows you everything Catwoman did. So
it's like When in Rome or something like sense. That or something like that.
Yes, exactly. I think that's why. I love that name,
by the way. I'm pretty sure I have that, yeah. I'm quite positive I bought that. I don't know if I ever read it, but I know I got it.
Catwoman's also a lot of fun because every time she's around Batman, she's always like, Batman, do you know how aroused I am right now?
Yes.
Do you know?
She's very sexualized. She's extremely sexualized.
It's just funny.
I can't remember. Do they know who each other are in this? Like, do they know?
No.
Do they know that they're Bruce Wayne and Selina?
If they do know, they never once communicated that in the story.
Okay. I can't. Yeah, it's been a while. I only remember that she scratches him. Doesn't she scratch him? And I could have sworn that came into play, but that might be something else.
There was something like that, but it wasn't Catwoman. I think Poison Ivy is what you're thinking of.
Well, I know Poison Ivy mind controls him at some point or whatever, but or whatever you call that pheromone thing. But I could have sworn Catwoman like scratches him on the lip or something, like with her claw, and then she notices it later on Bruce Wayne. But this is, like I said, I could be blending.
I don't remember that. I mean, it's possible I missed it because I'm not a very visual person.
Right.
So unfortunately, I miss a lot when I read comics. It's one reason why I never got into the medium.
Sure.
Because, I mean, movies and books are all about the feels, and I feel like comics kind of struggle in that sometimes.
Right.
I do remember Selina Kyle and Batman are on a date, and they run into Poison Ivy, which I thought was one of the weirder scenes in the story because
why would
you take a rose from a green woman in a hood? I just think that's a little suspect.
Yeah, I see that right now, actually. Interesting, yeah.
I didn't see it coming because I did not expect a huge gallery of villains in this story. The way the story is set up, it looks like tried and true Tim Burton Batman. So when you run into Grundy, it's like, holy shit, that's fucking Grundy. So it's, you don't
think I love Grundy in this book. I love Grundy. He's a lot of fun. He's just saying his fucking rhyme. It's just so much fun. And he's not even necessarily a bad guy. He's just a big fucking brute that doesn't really understand. And he's not like, I don't know, it's just really interesting how they play off Grundy.
He's very sympathetic in this story.
Yeah, exactly. It's such good writing for his character. I mean, not necessarily Grundy needs to be sympathetic, but I mean, it's just so good. It's so well done in here that this is what made me like Grundy as a character. Going into Injustice, I was happy to see Grundy, and I was happy to see him in Arkham City and all that, just because I like how he's portrayed in this book.
Well, the problem is the things I love about Grundy in this comic just do not translate in the cartoon or in the video game, unfortunately.
Snake face! Snake face! Bird lady! Snake face!
Okay, yeah, that's just good.
He's funny in the cartoon.
There's a really good line with, I don't know, forgive me if I said this on the last Graveyard, but he has a great line with Green Arrow. And Green Arrow is like, can you say fire bad, Grundy? And Grundy's like, but fire is bad. I was like, that's fucking good. That's good.
He's entertaining. I think he's entertaining. He's not always well written or always well portrayed. Especially in Injustice, he wasn't necessarily, like, he wasn't a sympathetic character. He wasn't a very fun character on how he was, like, the role he played. I don't even remember what the hell he did in story mode.
He was henchman number 4.
Yeah, exactly. And that's a shame. It feels like NetherRealm, not to sit here and like go on a knocking NetherRealm moment, but they don't, like, it's kind of like Ferritor, it's kind of like Reptile, it's like the henchman characters, Baraka's, they just don't have a whole lot of personality, which is a shame, because you can, and that's why I mean, not to go on a whole tirade again on the whole soapbox of saying I wish the story mode was just like a 2-hour cutscene movie that they actually take the time in to write really well, instead of trying to force it into the gameplay, and thus, you're kicking certain characters' ass, so they're always getting beaten, usually the villains, and it's just eh.
Yeah, and it really made Killer Frost's inclusion feel like a waste when you, like, bring out this obscure character who does nothing, absolutely nothing.
Right.
So that was disheartening, but I don't know. So if Grundy does come back, which I feel like his chances are slim, not impossible, I think his chances are better than maybe we think, but if he does come back, I'd like to see a smarter take on him, but we'll see.
Yeah, he's kind of riding the Arkham City wave back then. Now he's not as relevant.
When Arkham City had a great showing, I didn't see that shit coming at all.
Yeah, no, I didn't either. So yeah.
And he was fucking huge. It goes back to what I was praising Killer Croc for, was just menacing, giant.
Right.
You don't want to be in the room with him. Like, that's... I've never gotten that from Grundy before.
Right. I have here... I'm on a panel with Scarecrow on a horse. Scarecrow should always have a horse. This dude is great on a horse. He does. He looks badass. I mean, he was in... he was on a horse in Batman Begins as well, and that was really cool, but yeah.
Yeah, well, I mean, yeah, that was one of the best showings for Scarecrow in that movie, but, well, no, I think he had a better showing in Dark Knight Rises. I thought that was really fucking
good.
Yeah,
that was
good. He had a really good one in Dark Knight, too. Actually, maybe Horse is number three, but, yeah, I really liked, you know, revisiting the Scarecrow throughout all the Nolan movies. I thought that was really sick.
Right, right, and that's what I wish more comic book movies had, is more repeating which characters they use. There's nothing wrong, in my opinion, in getting a cameo from a character, because that's comic books. That is, I mean, you can say Nolan movies weren't very comic booky. They were more like dark and gritty, which they were. By all means, they were. And Marvel movies are much more comic booky. But something the Nolan movies got right is repetition of use of characters. They were gonna bring back the Joker in Dark Knight Rises had Heath Ledger not died. They had Scarecrow in every single one of the movies. He just played a minor role in the other two. That's great. And they had Ra's al Ghul come back for a short cameo.
Also very well done. Yeah. I thought that was a good scene.
Yeah, and that's comic books. That seeing the villains come back is paramount. That's one thing in the old movies, like the Burton movies and the Schumacher movies, that they never did right, was they never brought back the characters. They would always kill them off or something. And it's like, I can't stand when that happens. And they didn't do it like... They didn't... In Spider-Man, yeah, Green Goblin was constantly referenced and brought back, which was good. But, I mean, it was just never... It was never the same. I love that Nolan actually... Batman was still fighting these characters in between movies and still in the movies. He put away the Scarecrow to start off The Dark Knight. That was genius, because he put him away, in Batman Begins as one of the main villains. So now let's have him be like a little side character in this one. That's great.
No, and I think the moral of Batman in general is you never stop fighting evil. The battle never ends, yeah. But you have to keep fighting it. That's a great, you know.
And he never kills anybody, so they're always coming back.
No, precisely, you know. And I think comics in general kind of ride that wave. It's a very good message, and it's a very good premise to build upon, you know. So, yeah, I like the little surprises, because they're all surprises. I did not expect to see Poison Ivy. I did not expect to see Grundy. I thought they were all... I didn't really expect to see Scarecrow, to be honest with you.
Yeah. I liked Scarecrow's and Joker's small parts throughout. And I liked... One villain that I think definitely needs a reference is the Riddler. I thought he was really well done here as well. Like, as the smart person... Like, you... Even he was questioned of being the holiday killer, and it's like I love the part he played in helping Batman, or whatever you want to call what he was doing.
Well, they actually integrate him in the plot in a very smart way.
Right.
Unlike Poison Ivy, I feel like Poison Ivy's inclusion was mostly to increase the bulk of the comic series. She's mostly there just to expand running time. You know, Bruce Wayne has to get possessed temporarily.
Sure.
Catwoman has to save him. Nothing wrong with that. But ultimately, it doesn't really go anywhere. Riddler does. Riddler, they bring in, I think the Falconis bring in Riddler to question him.
Yeah.
And say, who is the killer? And the Riddler says, I think three things. He points out three people. And his final one is, and when he, I think, just grabs him by the shoulders and says, just tell me, who do you think the killer is? And he goes, you. You're the obvious choice then. And then they just kick him out. And he's also the April Fool's killing.
Right.
Where you think they're going to kill him, and he doesn't. So in the theme of the holiday, someone doesn't die on April Fool's. I thought that was
right.
Very clever. So yeah, the Riddler was well done. His personality was kind of suppressed. You know, his interactions, unfortunately, are not quite as interesting because he's part of the plot.
Yeah.
He can't really have too much fun. They can't run amok, but still very well done, though.
Right. Definitely. Yeah, it's just, oh man, it's just so much good stuff here, and skimming back through this, and yeah, and a lot of the crime families, the Falconis and the Maronis and all that good stuff, they they take up a good bulk of it, and they're big characters in this. And yeah, and I like seeing Riddler come back. Like, he was brought back a little bit later on, kind of another interaction between him and Batman, and a lot of good stuff here. And I mean, let's get down to the nuts and bolts of it. I thought it was really good, in my opinion. I thought I liked how Harvey Dent was portrayed, and I liked how, you know, they kind of played that up. This is the ultimate telling of Harvey Dent's, you know, changing into Two-Face, and I thought it was really well done, in my opinion.
Yes, I would say that. Most of the story is Harvey Dent.
Right.
I feel like I would have liked a little more of his bipolar nature to show up here and there, which, and at the very end of the story, you find out it kind of did.
Yeah.
You don't find out to the very end, but he very much is, you're saying, down to earth defense attorney. What is his position again?
Who?
District attorney. That they pretty much play that up the whole time, and you don't find out that he has sort of a weird off side to him till the very, very end, and it kind of colors the way you saw the previous part of the comic. But it's still very well done. Like, when fucking, the assistant of Harvey Dent is handing him the antacids, I didn't make the connection to, like, 3 pounds before it happened that was the acid. That was the acid that gets thrown in his face. So, yeah, no, it still is very suspenseful, even if you know Two-Face up and down.
Right.
Yeah, but, I mean, like, Harvey Dent as a character, there's a very interesting part of the comic where he thinks Bruce Wayne is the holiday killer.
Yeah.
Very underplayed. They fucking rush through that, which I thought was lame. I wanted to really stew in that and, you know, have them question Bruce Wayne, have Harvey confront Bruce Wayne, have Bruce Wayne be forced to defend himself without saying, "I'm the fucking Batman," you know, and that never happens. Literally, like, he goes to court, he's like, "I'm not the holiday killer," and we never revisit that plot thread ever again. That was kind of disappointing.
Yeah. And then let's talk about the ending here with his wife, Gilda. Your thoughts?
I'm still not sure I quite understand it. So she was the one putting the holiday items near the killing scenes. Am I right about that?
I wasn't sure what to think. Was she the holiday killer and she was doing it for some reason?
It sounds like initially Harvey Dent was the one putting the holiday items in front of the killings. And I'm not clear why.
Because, yes, it ends with her burning the items. So, like, the trench coat, the hat, the gun and everything. All the, you know, the items the holiday killer would use. So, I don't know. It's interesting because she's kind of... It kind of leaves off in a way that she's either... She's cleaning up after her husband's mess, but she knew all along what he was doing type of thing. Or... I don't know, it's interesting, but she ends it off with, "I believe in Harvey Dent," so it's kind of in a way of, was it her, was she in on it with Harvey, were they both, you know, in on it, what was going on there, I don't know, it's interesting.
Well, I'm reading the wiki page, where it says she claims that she took it upon herself to start the holiday killings in an attempt to end the Romans' hold on Gotham. But that doesn't make sense. I thought we knew with complete certainty that Falcone's son was the holiday killer.
I don't know. See, that's the thing is, that's the fun part of it, I guess, is that all the people that they kind of point fingers at, be it Calendar Man, Falcone's son, Harvey Dent, his wife Gilda, I don't know if it ever really is 100% without a doubt confirmed. I don't know.
Well, even though I just read the comic, I can't remember exactly how they catch the Falcone's son. I can't remember how he gets incarcerated. But it implies in the Wikipedia page that she was the killer the whole time, and then Dent started taking over the killings when she stopped.
Which...
And that means...
To me, I mean, my initial... I'm trying to remember what I initially felt or thought when I was finished reading it, because I remember being really shocked that of her inclusion on it. So I don't know if that was what I thought, but I mean, the looking at the ending pages, that definitely seems like it's quite a possibility that she was, because I mean, her final words are, "I did what needed to be." Or she goes, I'll just read the whole thing, 'cause it's the last couple pages.
Sure, yeah.
She says, "Harvey," and this is after Harvey's already incarcerated, so he's already sitting in jail or prison or whatever, Arkham. "Harvey," and she's carrying a box. She's in the basement. "Harvey, I need what I needed. I did what needed to be done. Do you remember? You promised we would finally have time together when you didn't have so much work to do." And now she's burning things. "I read your case files about taking serial numbers off guns and how a baby bottle nipple would muffle the sound, how clues are left at murder scenes. And I thought if I did that, Batman would think it was someone extraordinary and not me. I used your hat and coat for disguise and left those things at the killings. Johnny Vitti was the first. Then again, on Thanksgiving, I left the hospital while you slept. And again, on Christmas. But when Alberto Falcone was shot on New Year's and you came home late that night, your hair was wet even though you were wearing a hat. I found the gun in the basement. You told me it was evidence, but I knew. You had the same idea as me. You picked up where I left off, so we could have time together. A child, a secret. Let them think it was Alberto. No one will ever find out, because they don't have you to help. You are my Apollo. You can do no wrong. I believe in Harvey Dent." So I guess that is the big twist. I had a hard time remembering whether it was Harvey Dent or his wife, but it was both of them. And I think that's what blew me away at the end, because I think all of us were thinking it was either, you know, Calendar Man, or most likely the mob's person's son, or even Harvey Dent towards the end. But I don't think anybody suspected his wife, and that's what it turned out to be, is a mixture between his wife and Harvey to a degree.
See, I just completely misunderstood the ending. I thought it was still Alberto, but she left all that holiday bullshit. I just didn't understand it.
Like, yeah, she was saying, let them think it was him. She was flat out saying, I did this so we could spend more time together. And then it looks like he started doing it too, to like keep it going. And yeah, like that's pretty awesome. I don't know. I just think that's not something anybody expected, but it kind of, I don't know. It just works.
No, it is. It certainly is cool. I'm still confused on how they had a silent understanding that because it looks like they never discussed it. Like, right. Am I right about that? How would he know to resume the killings?
It's been a while. I don't know. I have no idea. I don't know.
There had to be some. Well, she didn't know he was resuming the killings until she saw that his hair was wet when he came home.
And we don't necessarily know that he did do anything. It could be just her presumption that he was doing it. I don't know.
Yeah, I'll be honest with you. I'm still a little confused on how that happened. I'm not 100%.
But that's what makes it a good mystery novel. It's not obvious, and it still leaves you with a couple questions of, like, I can't remember if Dark Victory keeps it going or not. I should grab that real quick. I know you haven't read it yet, so I won't spoil anything, but I read through it, and I know it picks up where it leaves off. Like, it keeps going. I don't think it... Let me find it here. Dark Victory. Alright. Because I know it takes place, and this one has Batman and Robin, so I know this is more of a Robin story, but I feel like it... For some reason I remember it continuing it to a degree. I don't know, it's hard to tell just by picking it up, but... I mean, it's got Two-Face and stuff, so... I don't know. Obviously, yeah, it's been a while, but no, yeah, it does, because you see some bits of Calendar Man and stuff, so I won't go any further, but yeah, it looks like it keeps the story going to a degree. I don't know how much, to what extent. I don't think it's the main story, but...
Well, it's very clear in the story that Harvey Dent and his wife do not have a conversational understanding that each one is that the other is the killer, because she accuses him of having a nipple in the basement.
Right.
That's really weird verbiage. Yeah. And then and having, you know, filing whatever filing particles from metal shavings.
Right.
From a gun, you know, so. Yeah, I don't know. It's interesting, though. But overall, fantastic story. Like I said, it's a great journey. It is so good. And, I mean, if you like Batman and you like Detective Batman and you've never had that in a healthy dose, this was my first really generous serving of Detective Batman. My gosh, this is a fucking good story.
Yeah, yeah. And I remember Dark Victory kind of keeps it going. I don't think it's as heavy as The Long Halloween on that, but I know it keeps going. I was just skimming through it. And yeah, it definitely keeps going with a lot of the same characters. So we'll just have to see. But yeah, I love The Long Halloween. I love every bit of it and just fascinating. And like I said, I love the detective aspect and just one of the best for that, if not the best, in my opinion, from what I've read. It's really, really good. So can't recommend it enough, but so good.
You want to talk about great showings?
Well, great showings for me are definitely Batman and Catwoman themselves are really good. I think it's going to be tough for me because I feel like I love every little bit of it. Grundy was tremendous, like we said. He was really well written and surprising. Catwoman was really well written and not surprising, but she was really, I loved the interaction between them. Calendar Man, I don't think has ever been done better. I don't know. It's just tough. I mean, Gordon's done well, so the mob and everything. So yeah, it's hard for me to pick one specifically other than the ones we've kind of mentioned.
I would agree with all of those. Gordon was going to be one of my choices. I think Gordon was fantastic, and he always is. I love Gordon. I think Tim Burton fucked up by not emphasizing.
Oh yeah, yeah, more. Definitely.
Grundy was probably one of the most pleasant surprises. Poison Ivy, even though I didn't really care for her role as much, it was still a really cool twist that she was even in it. You know how I don't really like Plant Ivy. You know, I mean, the appeal of Poison Ivy is you don't know how dangerous she is until she's already got you in her snare.
Sure.
So when she dresses like
a witch. Glad you said snare there.
Well, I mean, you know. But when she dresses like a plant, it's not nearly as effective, in my opinion. Like, especially when she has, like, leaves and shit, like, sticking out. Like, she covers, like, 6 feet of space. Like,
it's just,
I don't think it's nearly as effective. I like normal, deceptive-looking Ivy better than, you know, Bush Ivy. I mean, is this how I feel?
All right, sure. Ivy's Bush.
You know what it's like down there. Snare. You know it's all vines and shit. But if I had to say weak showings, I'd probably say the Joker. Really didn't feel like Joker needed to be in this.
But he was downplayed enough to where he didn't for. Which is another great thing about this book is Joker isn't the limelight character in here. There's other villains that get way better attention than he does, which is okay. He was just in the background, causing chaos, doing what he does. He was just a fun little thing there at the beginning, and then a couple other times throughout, but he was never, like, the main thing, which is good for once. I mean, he wasn't... That's also why this story in itself is refreshing, is it's not a Joker story. It's not a Joker-led story. It's just straight-up Batman being the detective and a lot of the other rogues kind of popping in for stuff.
Yeah, it's a sign of a very pre-canonical Harley Quinn type story, even though Harley Quinn was around when this was written.
Right.
Joker is kind of filling the function of Harley Quinn, where he's kind of just being all over the place, just laughing, doing silly stuff, you know?
Right.
Well, I feel like since Harley Quinn became official canon, Joker has been more sadistic than ever, and they've handed over the role of being all fun and laughy to Harley Quinn. Like I said, I'm not a huge comic book reader, so that may not be completely accurate, but...
To a degree, it's pretty accurate.
So, and then that's his role in the story. He doesn't really do anything that sadistic. He doesn't really do anything that sinister in the story.
No, he's which just is being fun. Nutso, yeah.
Yeah, his big showing was at the end when he gathered all the villains, including right. Two-Face, which I thought was cool.
Yeah.
So that was really cool. Yeah, overall good stuff. Very good. really, the biggest praise is not something I can articulate. The biggest praise is, like you said earlier, I didn't want to put it down. That was the biggest praise. Like, you can't really communicate what's so good about the story by just talking about it. It's the experience of going panel to panel is really what makes it such a well-written story.
It's definitely one that you just want to know what happens next, which is always the sign of a good story, for sure. But yes, wrapping it up, I would rate it... I'd probably give it a 9.5. I mean, it's not perfect, but it's, for me, it's one of the ones you have to read as a, if you're a Batman fan, comic book fan, or any of that kind of stuff, or if you like detective stuff, I thought it's really, really well done. It's great for that regard. So yeah, I'd give it a 9.5.
I would give it a 9, but that, I mean, for me, that's extremely high.
That's high praise.
That's extremely fucking high. Like 9.5 is reserved for, like, when I watch movies, like, there's maybe 3 movies I've seen in my life that got higher than an 8.5. Like, that's a really fucking good score.
Yes, people have to understand that our scales, you're about 2 behind me.
Like, you got a curve. You have to get a curve.
There's a curve. I'm always about, like, 2 points higher, full points. Like, if I'm giving something a 9, it's usually a 7 from temp. So it's good that he would give it a 9.
But a 6 for me is good. Like, if you get a 6, you get a lot of things right. So.
Yeah, no, it's just we rate things differently, and there's nothing wrong with that. It's just people need to understand there's a difference there, that there is a curve. We rate on different scales, and we have different kind of ways of doing things.
Maybe one day, like, you know, you, me, Razor, Shad, Django, we'll universalize a scale so we can kind of calibrate it. Yeah. But we haven't got a system going yet, guys. Right. So. You're gonna have to deal for the time being.
All right, well, that covers it for The Long Halloween and Blackest Nights. And what I want to do now is I want to recommend one for the next time we record, which isn't going to be for probably 3 weeks or whenever we do this. Who knows? We'll figure out what we want to do schedule-wise, but it'll at least be 2 weeks that you have to read the next one. And I'm trying to think. We might as well make it Dark Victory, because that's on, you already have it, and that's on kind of your short list, so might as well make it something you already have. Because I was going to recommend, there's a few that I'm going to recommend in time. Other ones are definitely Batman Year One is a very popular one. It's when he first becomes Batman, and his whole interaction with Gordon is really, really well written. So that's another really popular Batman one. That's usually top 3 in a top 10 list for Batman.
Well, even though I have Dark Victory, it's not the next one I'm going to read per se. I was going to recommend Kingdom Come.
Ooh, Kingdom Come.
But I can recommend Dark Victory. That's, I mean, that's, yeah, no problem.
Yeah, let's do Kingdom Come next. Yeah, let's do that, actually. And we'll
do you want to do 2 at
a time? Yeah, we can do 2. We can do 2, sure. We'll start off 2 now, since we're on a very long break in between episodes. Maybe if we, once the game gets announced and we get into hype mode, and if we start doing our show weekly or something, who knows how it'll go. But if that ever comes out to be, then yeah, maybe we'll start doing 1. But for now, we'll do 2. We'll do Dark Victory and Kingdom Come.
Yeah, that sounds great. I think that's a really good combination.
That way we can follow up on immediately on the Long Halloween storyline, which kind of wraps up in Dark Victory, other than Catwoman's little side tale, which I don't even remember. I don't even know if I ever read that. I know I have it, but I don't know if I got around to reading it. I have a lot that I still haven't read. I have probably like 20 graphic novels that I haven't read. I have a lot, and I have like 25 that I already have, or that I have read. So I've read a lot, but there's also a lot that I haven't read. And then Kingdom Come's another one that's a really good, I'd say that one's more good Superman tale more than anybody else, but it's got a lot of other characters in it. It's another, like, Blackest Night, in a sense that you're gonna see at least 30 characters, 40 characters in there get referenced, or, you know, have a showing, so to speak. But that one's a really good one, so definitely recommend that one. So those will be our 2, Kingdom Come and Dark Victory. So yep, get those read by the next time, so that way when we review it, you can share your thoughts, and we're not spoiling anything for you, so... Yes, and that will wrap it up for the very first episode of The Strip Show. Hopefully you guys enjoyed our strip show. And did you have anything else to cover or anything else to comment on?
No, not really. Just the way we're going to proceed from here, I guess, is just kind of diversify and make sure we cover, like, it's not going to be the Batman segment. It's not going to be like...
No.
Yeah, we're going to diversify as much as we can.
Batman's my favorite, but I like a large variety of heroes. So you're going to get Marvel, you're going to get DC. You're probably going to get more DC than Marvel, for sure. Well, it's not even going to be a probably. It's going to be a for sure, just because the whole injustice factor, if they do announce it. Obviously, we want to educate people. Both Brandon and myself want to learn more about these characters, but also... we want to educate all of you. Obviously, we have some people that are more, you know, versed in the comics than others, but we want everyone else to learn more about these characters and appreciate them more and find ones that they like, find ones to root for, to hopefully be in the game, etc. Leading up into the game, and the only way to do that is to learn more about the DC characters. Other things I want to personally touch on is maybe start reviewing some Batman animated series episodes. I have that all on DVD. I think it's even up on Netflix. I at least know the Justice League are. So there's that. I want to do Justice League, which will obviously be great to tie into Injustice. Batman animated series is always great. And Young Justice we could cover at some point, because that's also up. And that's only like 2 seasons, I think. And at least the first season's up on Netflix. So I want to cover all of this kind of stuff and give everyone quite a bit of content to divulge in. And these also want to do character retrospectives, kind of like how we did the Mortal Kombat ones, except for it's going to be less about what our favorite, you know, outfits, fatality. Obviously none of that's going to apply here. Instead, it's going to be informational. We're going to read character bios, we're going to show pictures of the characters in the video. Those will probably be more like our Injustice videos, but we'll do, and it probably won't even be, it may or may not be a part of this show itself. It may not be a part of the strip show. Maybe its own thing. I don't know. Whatever best way to do it would be, but I would
if
like...
If there's a character announced for Injustice, it would be great to do a retrospective for every announcement.
Exactly. Every time somebody's announced, I would... It's not even really a retrospective. It'd be more... I mean, it's kind of a retrospective, but it would also be just more just share... Like, telling you who that character is, the great things that they do... the alliances they have, more about the character and their power sets and potential moves they could have, more stuff like that. So it won't be like the Mortal Kombat ones where we're kind of reminiscing on the past, as you know, it'll be more informational. So
we can take requests to an extent. I mean, if you guys want to hear something or hear us talk about something or you want us to read something, I mean, We probably can't do it on a pure request basis, because it would be so random if we did that. But we'll consider anything for sure. I know Smoke Man wants us to talk about Black Manta. Smoke Man loves Black Manta, and I would love to talk about Black Manta. I think Black Manta is very interesting. So yeah, stuff like that we could definitely kind of, at the very least, maybe give our 2 cents on. You know.
Yes, and we'll take a lot of requests in that regard. Also, requests for reading. I will be completely up for. There's so many that I already have that I want other people to read that I've read that I wouldn't mind reading again. There's so many of the, like, The Dark Knight Returns, one of the best, if not the best, Batman story ever written. That's a must read. And it's not going to be all Batman. Like, you're going to get your Kingdom Comes. You're going to get your Blackest Night, as we said. You're going to get Superman Red Sun is even a decent one. I mean, it's not... I wouldn't say that's the best one, but it's a really interesting book, and it's a really interesting story, and it's well written, and that's one that I enjoyed reading as well. Obviously, if you played Injustice 1, you know, you saw the skins of what the Red Sun is, so you kind of get an idea of what it's about. Superman, and if Superman crash landed in Russia instead of, you know, the U.S. So, but it's got a lot more than that. It's not just about Superman. It's got Batman and how he would be if this happened, and if there was that threat there, and everyone looks a little bit different. Everyone plays different roles. It's really interesting. It's got some villains in there that, you know, it's got some surprises in there. So it's not all just, you know, cut and dry. It's not boring. It's still an interesting book. And I have a few other ones that aren't necessarily Batman stuff to read. And I have some Marvel ones that I would like to get to at some point too, like Spider-Man Blue, Daredevil Yellow. Those ones are both really, really good. Also, Batman, The Court of the Owls. We need to get to that at some point. But these are all in the future. We got plenty of time. But yes, next episode, try and get Dark Victory and Kingdom Come, so you'll get a little bit of everything there. And on that note, did you have anything else you wanted to discuss?
Good.
All right. For the first strip show, hopefully you guys enjoyed, and we're going to... I meant to mention this right off the top, but I want this to be a little bit more upbeat, happy, fun, not really bitchy, complainy. This is gonna be more fun and just enjoying ourselves. I feel like we've been, at least me especially, has been really negative lately, and you know, I'm wanting to get into hype mode and just have fun again, and I know people want that as well. Not everyone wants to just listen to complaining and moping and just constant negativity, and I don't want that to be what our channel represents necessarily either. I don't want NetherRealm, WB, or any of our listeners or anybody else to think, oh, these are just the guys that bitch about everything and complain about everything and are constantly negative and just tearing things apart. It's like, I don't want that to be. I want to be a channel that takes things in stride and, you know, talks about the good and the bad. I don't want to be happy-go-lucky people that are blind to all this, you know, bullshit as either, but I just want to be brighter and not be that people that are passed up of being the people that bitch all the time, because we're never going to be listened to. NetherRealm is never going to give us the time of day if we're just constantly complaining. So I feel like we need to find a happy medium and find a nice way to represent our thoughts without constantly just shitting the bed and complaining. So
yeah, every like one thing I complain about, there's like 10 things I'm in love with.
Right.
For everything, for Mortal Kombat, for DC, everything.
And yeah, and that's kind of where I feel like I hope people don't get that impression, because leading up to the game, we had a lot of great things to say. And somebody even pointed that out, is, well, how come you guys were, you know, gushing over everything leading up to the game, and then afterwards you're just shitting on all these things? It's like, well, it's because leading up to the game, I mean, the game itself, all of us think is a great game. It's not even that, it's just, as things come out, we got to give our reactions to them. We're just kind of interacting, or we're reacting naturally. And certain, you know, with the combat pack, unfortunately, the DLC characters, there was a lot of things that people didn't agree with. That's just kind of how we felt. But, and the online netcode wasn't very good. And, you know, certain aspects of like, there's just certain problems that after the honeymoon period is over, you know, the problems are going to arise, and that's just going to be what it is. But yeah, all in all, I'm sure we're all very positive and have more good things to say about the game than negative. It's just, we said all those good things for months and months and months, and even when the game came out, we initially just loved everything. We talked about everything we loved. So I mean, you got both sides. It's just unfortunate that all the good stuff was there and then a lot of the bad stuff was there for a while. So, but anyways, going on a little rant, has nothing to do with this. Overall, I just want you guys to know that I'm hoping for this show to be a lot more upbeat and a lot of fun, so join us for this ride, and hopefully, if you're not so open into the comic book world, try and be, because trust me, there's a lot of fun that can be had, and there's a reason why a lot of these characters are beloved and have lasted, you know, 75 plus years, because there's some great stories to be, you know, read in there. And if you're not super into comics, at one point, I wasn't super into comics. I wasn't a comic book reader up until like 2010, 2011 or whatever. It was like a year before Injustice came out that I started really getting into comics. I was always the kid that was super into watching the movies, the cartoons, the playing the video games. I loved everything about superheroes growing up. I played with the toys and all that fun stuff. But I was never super into reading the comics. I'm not a big fan of reading books in general, and part of that is probably why I didn't really give comics a try. But trust me, comics are fun, and they have really good stories and great art. So if you like any of those things, and great characterizations, if I was always somebody that watched the movies and thought, man, these are amazing, trust me, the best Batman stories, the best any superhero story is not on screen. No matter what character it is, be it the X-Men, the Avengers, any of those characters, Batman, Superman, trust me, the movies and the stories that are told on screen aren't nearly as good as they are in the comic books. Trust me on that. The animated series of Batman and the Justice League animated series and the X-Men animated series, those do a good job of encompassing what the comics are about, and those are the closest thing to the comics. But if you want the best stories told, you gotta go to the comics. So if you want to get serious about these at all, you gotta give it a try. I would start with the ones we're recommending, because these are the ones that are gonna win you over. Don't just start reading random Batman 232 from, like, you know, 30 years ago. That's not gonna help you do anything, or whatever character it is. You're gonna want to start on the best stories, and that way you can kind of see, you'll fall in love with it from there. That's how it worked for me anyways. And I'm hoping Brandon Sir Temp here will do the same. He'll start getting more into it just based on how great these stories are. But anyways, enough tangent, fun talk, greatness. On that note, we are wrapping up this strip show. Hopefully you guys enjoyed it, and adios. Until next time, check out those comic books.
Yeah, take care.